sustain and produce this show every Saturday night. So I'll be posting that in the chat room, or you can go to Global Peace Tribe on GoFundMe and ping us some green love at whatever level you feel inspired. And now we'd like to turn it over to Mark Sims. Would you like to introduce Mark, Alan?
And you're when meeting. I met Mark, it was like meeting a brother from another planet. No, he has a sparkle. He has a joy and a passion because, well, he had an amazing experience. And maybe we'll talk about this with this other dimensional being. And when you have a direct experience, your life changes. And whatever was happening before is kind of pushed to the back burner. And you realize what this incarnation is all about. And I think Mark is now at the forefront of a people's movement along with Danny, and he's bringing people together. He's inspiring people, and it's this passion for all of us to tell who we really are. We're part of a cosmos. We're not freaks of nature. We're not an accident of some lightning striking some amino acids in a warm pool. There is a higher consciousness that is being infused into us, and we are about to wake up to who we really are. And I love that Mark is one of the leaders of this charge. So Mark, I'm so happy you're here and taking charge, moving forward. Thank you. Unmute.
Well, thank you for that enthusiastic intro. And it's a real honor to be called a brother. You are as well a brother. We have had such a wonderful time together in the last few months, and getting to know you has been one of the joys of this process of disclosure personally for myself. Being introduced to people like you, getting to know a community of people. Some of you here have become some of my closest friends. Danny Sheehan, you, Alan, Whitley Strieber has become a dear friend and colleague. And Jimmy Church now, he and I feel like we're brothers and sisters with Deborah. I love you all. You are my family. I'm not kidding. That's the way I feel about all of you. And it's because, in part, at least, because we've all been through something together. I have luckily, and it wasn't this way at first, like Whitley, you know, the original contact was quite a shock and took me time to integrate. But here I am 9 years later. It's taken me to muster the courage and develop the confidence to be putting myself out there and share my story, because I have a unique story to tell. I spent 13 days continuously with an extraterrestrial. And what I learned over that 13 days absolutely blew my mind. And I'm sharing that story in the book form and through storytelling, through these events and importantly, if not most importantly, in the upcoming event of the Harmonic Convergence 2021, which I'll talk more about. So with that, I want to introduce our first song. This is a song that was done by a dear friend of mine, a famous music composer and producer out of Los Angeles named Bruce Sugar. You should check him out, brucesugar.com. He's got his own website. He's the who's who in music production. He has worked with Paul McCartney, Ringo Starr, everybody who's anybody. He's just amazing. I could go on and on. And he and I formed a friendship back in 2016 doing a song for Standing Rock that became the anthem for that activist movement when Danny Sheehan and I and a bunch of other people went out to South and North Dakota to protest the building of the pipeline there. And it was Bruce Sugar who produced the song called "The Whole World Is Watching" that's now on YouTube, seen over 7 million views. And he produced this song I'm going to play called "The Arrival Countdown." So let's kick this off.
So that was Jimmy Church on the lead guitar. Was that right?
All right.
So, Danny, I just got to jump. That was amazing, Mark. Can you tell us again who that was and who was singing?
That was Jimmy. I'm sorry. I was going to say Jimmy Church, of course. No, that was Bruce Sugar, and he has a group of singers that he hires to do backup for all of these famous musicians. And they're just the who's who of backup singers. They, in fact, one of the women, I was at the studio yesterday with Bruce Sugar, and we were recording a new song for this year's Harmonic Convergence.
I saw the pictures. I saw the pictures that you posted of that.
Yeah.
This is, I'm going to say it. That's like better than the original with Joey Tempesta in Europe.
Right?
That's strong, man. I was air guitaring.
All right. I'm glad you enjoyed that.
Incredible. Okay, I'm out. I had to jump in. That was just incredible.
It's great, Jimmy. Thanks for that. And so, going to go back to, okay, I'm in speaker view now. I'm getting some guidance on my cell phone since I'm host, so be a little patient with me. I'm getting the hang of this. And now on the agenda, I believe we have Whitley Strieber, and I'm trying to just bring up the agenda here real quick.
Yes, it is me.
Okay, it's you. Yes,
it's me.
All right. Let me bring up Whitley. Here's Whitley Strieber, my dear friend, and everybody knows Whitley from the books Communion, of course, that he published back in 1987, telling his story for the first time of being abducted. And more recently, he's published the books A New World, which I personally consider the most single important book written on this topic. And if you have not bought this book, you should buy it, keep it on your shelf. It's also available in audiobook, which he reads himself. He's an excellent reader. And I've listened to this book now at least a dozen times because he nails it. I think he's unraveled the enigma that is this phenomenon better than any single researcher. And his story is so powerful and it's so optimistic and mind-blowing at the same time. So that book, and then his most recent book, which is really somewhat of a break from his traditional writings, which is Jesus, A New Vision, which just came out a few months ago. That's also available on audiobook on unknowncountry.com. And he has also on unknowncountry.com a wonderful subscription opportunity for people with lots of information about his life story and podcast, the Dreamland podcast, and so many articles he's posted. This guy is really amazing. So, Whitley, thank you for being here tonight.
Well, with an introduction like that, I'm at a loss for words. No, not quite. That's a joke, believe me. That's one thing I'm not ever at a loss for, thank goodness. What I'd like to talk about is an arc that is contained in three books: The Afterlife Revolution, a new world, and Jesus, a new vision, which are all connected in an unexpected way. They all have to do with my very much still living muse and partner, Ann Streber, you can see behind me. I wear both rings now, both of our wedding rings side by side, because as far as I'm concerned, we are now two souls using one body. And we're down to the one body, but we're still here. Now, why would I say that? The reason is this. Annie passed away in 2015. Some years before, she had identified the fact that contact with our own dead and contact with what we then thought of as aliens, and I don't even believe that's a reality anymore. There is no aliens. We are all in this universe together. We are all part of it. And no one is an alien. A lot of us look different because it's a big universe, and we have grown up in different evolutionary tracks. That's all. In any case, she came out of her office one morning and she said, "Whitley, this has something to do with what we call death." And she said that because letter after letter we got after the writing of communion would mention that dead friends and relatives had been with the visitors. And people were seeing them all at the same time. And when we began to have groups of people, when Ann figured out how to get the visitors to come to our cabin when there were people there, we began to have organized groups meeting them. It would often be true that someone who would encounter one of their own dead before the visitors showed up, and Annie would always say, "Okay, that means they'll be here tonight," and she was never wrong about that. Now, what does that mean? She died in 2015 in August, and immediately began establishing the fact that she was still here. I was at 9:30 that night. She died at 7:15. I was sitting in my living room, just bereft. It was, you know, we were so close. And I was saying to myself, Annie, if you are in any way still here, please let me know. The phone rang. And I thought, oh no, the last thing I want, because no one knew she was dead yet, except just a few very close friends. Was a friend of Ann's, and I answered, and she said, "Whitley, is Ann all right?" Because I just heard her voice in my head say, "Paul Whitley." And I thought, my goodness, what a strange coincidence. But this happened over the next 2 weeks, again and again and again, until I finally had to admit, she's here. And The Afterlife Revolution is a book about why that's true, and how to create in yourself a state which will enable you to live beyond the veil and live like the visitors live. For the most part, there is no veil between the living and the dead. We are very thick and very invested in time. And so we have this veil. We're kind of in tunnel vision in time, but you can rise up out of that. And when you do, you begin to come into contact with all kinds of different levels of being, including very physical aliens. I guess that we have to call them that because that's such a meme, but they're not aliens, as I say, your own dead friends and relatives and lots, lots more. The universe of consciousness is vastly populated. And I'll tell you something else about it. It can be scary, but it is also a lot of fun. It's tremendously energizing. And then the next book, the New World, was written with Anne and with the visitors. And we worked on it together, literally, physically sometimes, to make it what it is. The title comes from a statement that was made by a great man, Colonel Philip Corso, who years ago began to tell his story of life behind the scenes with this. And one of the things that happened during a contact experience was he was asked to turn off some radars by the visitors so they could leave a certain place in New Mexico. And he said, being a soldier, he said, in my business, they asked for 10 minutes. 10 minutes can be a long time, which is certainly true. And he had the radar. He said, what's in it for us? The answer was critical. A new world, if you can take it. That means if you can stand it, if you can handle it, if you can take it into your soul, heart, and body, if you can take it in every single way. That's why the book's called A New World, because we can take it. Now, the next book, Jesus, A New Vision, is a response to the negativity that is in the close encounter experience. I found the visitors to be very reflective, and the harder I worked on living the good, the better my relationship with them became. Now, one of the things that closes off the teachings of Jesus about the good from so many of us is that it is all mixed up in religious doctrine. What Jesus, A New Vision does is it extracts the teachings from the Christian doctrine and shows where that doctrine came from. It didn't come from Jesus. It came from Constantine 300 years after Jesus died. It frees the teaching from the doctrine and frees, I hope, the souls of everyone who reads it to understand a great secret, that the Beatitudes are a way of life, that if we bring that to this, we are going to have a marvelous relationship with this other world in all of its levels and manifestations. And it is necessary for academics, spiritual workers, scientists, anyone who is not engaged in a military response to step forth as best they can and make this work, because that's how it will work. Shoot 'em up is never gonna work, and they're gonna just sit there waiting for it to be over, because there's not a thing we can do to them in any case. So that's where I am right now. And so, speaking of being in a place, it's a lovely place to be here tonight. I can feel the tremendous energy of this, and I'm so thankful to Mark and Scott and Deborah for inviting me and for making all this happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Whitney, so much for being a part of this show again. These are really powerful times. Your message has always been so on the forefront of what's happening now. We appreciate you so much. We're posting your link into the chat room so that people can continue to connect with you on all that you're offering. And Mark, if you've got his website, maybe share that with him.
Yes, let me do that. It's unknowncountry.com, and I'll put it in the chat here in just a moment. I just want to mention, Scott, you're back on, and I think you've taken over some of the host functions, so I cannot spotlight people. I can't put multiple people up on the screen. All I can do is put one person up on the screen now that you're back on here. So I'm going to do my best until I can become host again. But now, with that, let me just Let me just see here. Scott was going to be introducing cornflour next. And
I can do that, Mark.
Yeah, could you do that for us?
Definitely. So now we are going to take the energy that Whitney has so gracefully brought us to and raise it up even another notch of consciousness. And that's certainly what cornflour can do. He is an incredible genre-bending vocalist, live looper, beatboxer, and his music is fusion of organic a cappella soultronic. And the main thing that happens is cornflour does improvisational songs and his own work. He channels from spirit and he takes us on an energetic journey of heart and soul, raising the frequency up to the next level. And he's totally aligned with all that we have going on here tonight. So he will transmit all that we're feeling and loving and opening tonight through his music. He's one of our favorite musical artists on Saturday Night Alive, and so happy to have you on this show, Cornflour. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Deborah. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Scott. And it's a huge honor, honestly, to be here tonight. I haven't really talked about this publicly to too many people, but having Whitley on tonight really is inspiring to me. When I was 7 years old, I started having dreams, at least what I thought were dreams, of extraterrestrial beings coming to my home and waking me up at night. And that went on. It was a reoccurring dream that kept revealing itself every night. And it was every night. I had it from the age of 7 to 13. And when I was 13, I was then visited by, I'll keep it short, it's a pretty deep story for me, but I was visited by this brilliant being that made me realize that it wasn't just a dream. But then my brother contacted me just a few weeks afterwards. You can tell in my voice, this is a lot for me to be talking about. But my brother contacted me. He's about 9.5 years older than I am, and he was living in New York City, and he had just read a book. And for some reason, he got inspired to call me and talk to me about it. He thought I'd be interested in it. And so he's telling me about this book and this story. And the story is basically telling so many things that were synchronicities to the dreams I had been having for the past 7 years. And I hadn't told my brother about it. And I then began to explain to him. And he said, you should read the book. It's called Communion. And in that moment, talking to him, and then I ended up reading the book and had just so many aha moments where I realized what was really going on. And anyway, I just wanted to share that story, the synchronicity of being on tonight with you, Whitley, and what an honor it is. Thank you so much for the work you've done. And it changed my life reading that and knowing that I wasn't alone. So anyway, let's drop into some music and hope you all enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cornflower. Amazing as always. Thank you, thank you. Beautiful. And Cornflower has an incredible offerings at his website. I'm going to post those in the chat room again. Anything you want to share more about what you offered, Cornflower, and what you have to offer?
Absolutely. Well, first off, I have so many hours of music available on my subscription service called the flowerseeds.vip, and you can sign up for $3.33 per month or more, depending on how generous you are. And you get a new live release every month, plus all of my back catalog. And there's literally over 60 hours of music on there. And so you get that all available onto your device as soon as you sign up. And but also, if you sign up to my email list, you get one free song. And when you sign up, you'll also be notified of my upcoming live stream concert that we're going to be putting on from this studio here in the next month or so. So if you want to join me for about a two and a half hour music event where it's just going to be this kind of sonic expression happening, please join us and sign up to my email list, and I'll be notifying everyone of the exact date and all the information.
Blessings to you, Cornflower. Thank you. And we're going to have you back again. Yes. And possibly for some more. So hang in there for more of Cornflower.
Thank you, Deborah.
And Mark,
Hello, everyone. We're having a bit of a technical difficulty. As you can see, Scott Katamas is actually one of the panelists. And when he came in, it took over my co-host status by default, and I no longer can control the spotlight, so I can't put up people on the screen. So I guess whoever is going to be talking will naturally be on the screen. We can't share faces on the screen. So we're trying to solve this right now. Scott is talking to, he actually had somebody else log in as him. So Scott actually is not able to give me host status. There's somebody else who's logged in as him so he can stream on Facebook. It's a bit complicated, but we're trying to get to the bottom of it. And in the meantime, we have this three-way dialogue set up in the next portion of the agenda. And I'm gonna go ahead and I assume that people can now see me. So we're gonna take a moment and give Scott some time to try to fix this so I can then spotlight the three of us. It's going to be me, Danny, and Steve Bassett. So as soon as I get that, we'll go to this. In the meantime, we have, after the three of us, we have Deborah is going to introduce Larissa Stowe's video, Let Your Love Flow. And so maybe let's do that. Let's see if we can, what I think we should do actually is I'm going to ask if, Sylvain, if you could come on and we're going to put you on next. And if you could share with us more about your organization, which is very, relevant to tonight's show, I'm going to introduce you. So we're going to swap you out. So if you could unmute yourself, Sylvain, and I'm going to pin you up here. That's about all I can do. Why don't you, you're the one of the partners of an organization called the Alliance for Extraterrestrial Diplomatic Contact. So you're based in Canada. You're in the Ottawa area. So why don't you share with everyone what your organization is about and the origins of it and what you're doing?
Thank you, Mark. It's such a pleasure to be here with you guys. It's like learning about a family I've never met. Because I feel very connected with you guys. I've been since I'm a little boy. I wanted to save humanity, and so because I didn't know what that meant, I just felt that there was a lot of stuff going on in the world, and I needed to do something about it. And I mean, long story short, this is my mission, right? Is to bring us all together, bring peace, love, harmony, and not only on planet Earth, but also connected to extraterrestrial civilizations, because we are all one, it's the same universe. We're all connected. Everybody's connected. Everything is connected. So I've been working with different organizations for, you know, since I'm about 15 years old, and sort of over 30 years. And I've been a member of the Aurelian movement specifically since I'm 15. Working with that organization that believes in extraterrestrial, that extraterrestrials created life here and so on for all that time, and among other things. But the Alliance itself is specific. This is a not-for-profit that I created along with other members 6 months ago. And the first purpose of that is like we talked about, I'm going to share my screen here, earlier, is because of the Disclosure Project and how it's kind of opened up. And one of the missions of the movement itself, the promoter organizing that kind of founded the Alliance in some way, is like we want to build an embassy. We want to welcome you know, extraterrestrial civilization in an embassy, kind of in an official way. But this is not a just one organization program or idea. This is a project for the world, for everybody. It's not just one ideology or one subset of people and so on. So we created the Alliance to gather as many organizations as possible to bring resources together to make this happen, to create an embassy, to create a discussion at the national level with governments and diplomats and so on, to get the discussion going at that level. Now, the tribe has been doing the grassroots, just like we've been doing on our own side. And that's amazing, and we should continue that. But in parallel, we decide, well, let's get the embassy built. Let's do that work, and let's get the consciousness at those levels happen. So we've been at it for a while. Now, this is the website here. And the last 6 months, what we've been doing, we've been gathering organizations that want to lay their support, to bring resources together. So the movement is there. You've got a public streaming network, a Buddhist center, the paranormal researchers are now of Ontario, in this case, have joined. And combined, we have over 100,000 supporters of officially meeting an extraterrestrial civilization. And we're currently in discussion with half a dozen other organizations that number a lot more supporters. And they are all kind of like us, like you, because I consider part of you, trying to strive for the same thing. So and with numbers comes authority and power, especially we're talking with politicians and diplomats, which is what we're doing. So numbers do count when you're talking to these people to get the discussion going at the UN, at a national level, a little bit like what some of the speakers have been talking about. We need disclosure. We need to talk about this. We need to open up to other civilizations. But we've been at it as a collective, as a group, because there's many organizations now and more coming, been collecting resources. Like, this is the plans for the embassy. And we got the blueprints, we got plans, we got a number of resources. This image here shows the embassies in the middle. We've got a wall, and then there's a whole city around it, convention center, a mock for the embassy so that people can visit, a research center to, because it's part of the idea of that, of the part around the embassy, which we'd also build, is to increase the knowledge. How do we merge with the environment? How do we as a humanity be more harmonized with each other, with what you understand of the real world, you know, pure water, basically build a little bit of simulation of a perfect society where people don't need to work, don't need to worry anymore, and can kind of strive and thrive all together. So we can do a lot of research about that and let it spread. And, you know, we've been in communication at least since 2019 with the United Nations. And they've asked us, OK, well, here's the process to get this process done, because if we want to have an embassy, it needs extraterritoriality, which is something a country can give. But we want the discussion at UN level. We want an additional protocol to the Vienna Convention that allows for extraterrestrial embassies, because that's not in the language of the conventions. We want the UN to have that convention and talk about it and establish what if a civilization comes, where should it go, how are they going to behave, the countries, not the aliens. We know they're going to be peaceful and they're going to be quite happy if we all gather together and with high desire. We've gathered with the organizations that we have currently, we've gathered $50 million in accessible funds so we can build the embassy and much of the infrastructure around it, depending on the nation. We have thousands of volunteers and experts of all sorts, at least 200 scientists that have signed up to help us out officially with their name listed and everything. And we have a growing network, and we expect by the end of this year to have over 2 million supporters of this alliance, and probably more by the way it's going. And so we have a lot of assets. We have much of what we need, and we have groups in Geneva talking to the UN and so on. What we need is we need to to have a nation given that's willing to give extraterritoriality for the embassy. So we're discussing with a couple of nations now, but more options is better because it's a big thing for nations. This project, once it's built pre-arrival, is worth about $2.4 billion to a local economy. So that's the pitch to the nations. Like, hey, this is going to be a touristic location. And once a civilization does arrive, oh my, it's going to be a massive boon to your economy. That's the pitch because that's what they care about. What we really care about is we want the wisdom of the extraterrestrials to come in, and we want to be part of a bigger civilization as people. That's what we want, because we still live in the current world that still works with economy and money and all these things that are basically distractions. And what we also need is we need more supporters. Because we're talking to diplomats, they listen more if you have more supporters. Because we're talking to politicians, they listen more if we can claim we have more organizations and more supporters. So that's the strategy to get into those discussions. So the Alliance itself is happy to lay all its support to what you guys are doing. Bar none, no problem. We're on board. And we'd like humbly to ask any of you that want to support the Alliance so that we do our work with higher effectiveness. And that's the only thing that we really ask for people when we talk to. And if you feel inclined to engage and be active as an organization or individual, welcome. We'll have a discussion and we'll see how that works. And we'll all work together towards the embassy side of things. So not the grassroots. This is more the embassy and the diplomacy aspects of things. And the Alliance is growing. It's philosophically varied even now, and it's getting more varied. It's exciting. We're getting into really interesting discussions all over with a lot of the organization individuals that are fascinated and that want a peaceful meeting, an official meeting, and a full officially disclosure, because we want to get a discussion going with our extraterrestrial brethren, right? And those of us that are involved or a little bit more connected with the project will also perhaps facilitate the building of what we call a Scientopolis, which would be a center near the embassy, perhaps whose purpose is to do research to expand the human experience, to make sure that we all together live in harmony with high science and low stress. We take care of the environment, and we live peacefully without any need for suffering or to be forced to work or things like that. We can, do a lot of research on AI and all sorts of technologies to free ourselves from labor and suffering, basically, medicine. I have a little video at the end to finish this off. But that's it. It's a humble project. But we are well on our way in 2022 to have the necessary clout politically, get a convention going at the UN, and open the embassy after it's all built in 2030. That would be the plan. I'll stop the share here. And that's what's anticipated with the resources that we have. That's really it. That's my work and that's my life right now.
All right. Well, thank you, Sylvain. During your talk there, there were so many comments about and questions that were very positive and inquisitive about what you're doing. And I encourage everyone to check out his website. The organization is Alliance for Extraterrestrial Diplomacy Contact. And it's allianceforet.org. I put it in the chat there, and you can check it out more. It's a very exciting idea, the idea that whose time has come, clearly. And I'm looking forward to learning more about it. I just met Sylvain through Alan Steinfeld 2 weeks ago, and we've had a number of Zoom chats because I knew nothing of him. And it was actually Stephen Bassett who first mentioned your organization to me And then a few days later, Alan Steinfeld actually introduced us over the phone. So it's been a real pleasure getting to know you, and I'm still learning more. And you're going to be on the Harmonic Convergence 2021 Making Contact event, which I'll be talking about here shortly. So, thank you so much for, participating in all that you've done. And so we're going to move right along here. Okay. The next part of the show we're going to do is our planned three-person little mini panel. My dear friend, Danny Sheehan, is sitting in the wings patiently, and I'm going to bring him up. Danny, you ready to join the group here?
Yeah, I'm sitting. I'm right here.
All right. So Danny just returned home to Santa Cruz. He was here. He actually spent the night here at my home in Ojai, California, where we had a number of meetings discussing the launch with the marketing team for the Harmonic Convergence 2021 event, Making Contact. And we're going to be talking more about that later. But we wanted to invite Steve Bassett to come and join in a discussion about disclosure and a citizens diplomacy initiative. We just heard from Sylvain and his organization and what they're attempting to do to bring this question up of how does a citizenry go about initiating contact with and diplomatic relations with extraterrestrial intelligence. So this is something Danny has given a lot of thought to. And I thought, Danny,
hey, we're up live. Thank you.
So Danny, I'm sorry. Would you mind, you and Steve have known each other for years. Mm-hmm. And yeah. In fact, you were part of Steve's Citizens Hearing for Disclosure back in 2013. Why don't you share with our audience how you met Steve and how you've worked together in the past, and then introduce them.
Wow, yeah. Well, Steve and I have been working together since the dawn of time. When Stephen first arrived back in Washington, D.C., he and I were together. We, in fact, went out and helped unload his car when he was setting up his first office there outside of Washington, D.C., to just come in and say, look, somebody in the UFO community has to take responsibility for keeping both feet on the ground and talking with representatives and their staff and coming to grips with the real world, which is functioning at a fairly low frequency in the realm of political reality in Washington, D.C., and work constantly to get the Congress to come forward, to have hearings, to call witnesses, to present to the people of the United States and the world the information that they can get from the executive branch to try to present this. So Stephen has been laboring in the vineyard in Washington, D.C. for it's probably 30 years now. He knows the exact dates of this, but I remember, and I said, look at bless Stephen Bassett, because he's doing this job. Other people are doing different things, having contact experiences, holding conferences, reaching out to people in the executive branch and having meetings. And Steve has been focused on trying to do everything that he can to get the executive branch to come forward with important information that we're all certain that they have, utilizing the authority of the legislature. Because after all, it is in fact the Senate and the House of Representatives that really constitutes the heart of the government of our country. They are the Article I power of our government. The President of the United States and the executive branch has set forth in Article 2, and there's been some tension historically from a constitutional point of view between the two branches, because the executive branch has a tendency over time to start to develop a certain sort of bureaucratic imperative where they mistakenly come to perceive themselves as the government. And they tend to not respond as effectively as they should to the legislature. And sometimes the legislature itself tends to yield up authority to the executive branch and kind of minimizes their kind of authority. So this has been the realm of Stephen Bassett for almost 30 years now, at least, and has been working. And everybody in the UFO community, when you think about Washington, D.C. and trying to deal with the legislative branch of government and getting hearings by the United States government, turn to Stephen Bassett to find out what the state, what the present status is, what the communications are with any of the people on the staff, how long it's going to be before we're going to be able to get them to have hearings. And the reality is that Stephen has the best insight of anybody in the UFO community right now about how this looks from the point of view of the legislature and from the Congress of the United States. How are they responding to the, for example, Lou Elizondo resigning in public protest as the head of the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Project, the United States Pentagon, coming forward along with Chris Mellon in reaching out to the New York Times and publishing the previously secret gun camera photos and video of real live UFOs, pushing the issue to get the executive branch to come forward and start making acknowledgments about the reality of the UFOs. So there's been this extraordinary process that's been going on, and Stephen will talk to us all about it here, that's been going on since December of 2017, actually a little bit before that, in October of 2017, with the coming forth of people joining the To the Stars Academy, a number of people from the inside of the intelligence community and national security state bureaucracy coming forward to form a group that was intending to try to push this process forward, and it resulting in the front page coverage of the New York Times, most recently now generating coverage by 60 Minutes of a full interview with not only Lou Elizondo as the director of the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Project inside the Defense Department, but also with Chris Mellon, who was the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Intelligence, both under President Clinton and under George W. Bush. And now the progress is being made with the work that everybody has been doing to try to move this process forward. We now have these government officials from previously within the executive branch itself, making statements that denying that these vehicles can possibly be from the Soviet Union or from China. We have the pressure they're putting on to the executive branch and the Defense Department to actually stating that these are not ours. The vast majority of these instances are not ours. Whatever the weight might be put on the negative pregnant, that some of them conceivably could be perceived as UFOs, that may be some technology of ours. But the bottom line is we're in an extraordinarily important period. And Stephen has a unique perspective to bring to the community, talking about these efforts that we're talking about generating citizen diplomacy, to reach out and try to establish direct citizen-to-citizen contact with the extraterrestrials. Stephen has invested extraordinary amounts of time into trying to make the government structures work to perform their constitutional duty, both the legislative branch in the House and Senate and in the executive branch. And so he wants to sound, I think, a constructive and affectionate note within the community to be careful here, to not do things that might interfere with the ongoing process that he's been working at for years, I think, to get this thing to happen within the constitutional government structures. And so that I want to, from the perspective where I am, of having been legal counsel, you know, for the Disclosure Project, legal counsel with Stephen in the citizens hearings, and now legal counsel for Lou Elizondo in his internal communications with the Defense Department, trying to get more information out of them. I want to be the one to endorse and support what it is Stephen is doing from his perspective, and encourage him and give him every opportunity possible to communicate his perspective to all of us as we're going forward with this process. So with all of that said, here he is, the man himself, Steve Bassett.
Thanks, Danny. Let me put it this way. There have been efforts to resolve this issue going all the way back to 1950, 51, a couple of years before enough sightings had occurred and things started to get cooking, all the way back to Donald Keough, which is, I think, the first activist, true activist. And they continued. But simple truth was, for the first 44 years from 91, from 47 to 91, there was no chance. There was simply no chance. Whatever you did, whatever you could come up with, no matter who you were, not gonna happen. That changed when the Cold War ended. Because, and the reason I say this is because the nuclear issue, the nuclear threat, the mutual assured destruction was a pretty potent issue, and the national security state was not going to defer on that. In other words, they were going to defend the country and prevent whatever could come from that. And anything else that might interfere, forget about it. Okay, that changed in 91. I entered the field in 96. So I was 6 years in. So that, first of all, that was a good thing, because the worst was over and the doors maybe could start opening. But I neglected to do something prior to that, and that was to get rich. I was terribly bad at making money. I mean, just awful. It was really kind of sad. So I entered the field with virtually no resources at all. So what? What are you gonna do? But I had one thing in favor of my particular approach. Nobody wanted to do it. Nobody had, really. I realized right away there was no lobbyist that had ever registered on the subject. Okay, I'll be the first one. No political action had been set up. I'll be the first one. Nobody had done an exopolitics conference. I did the first, I think, the first formal one, and then one in Washington. So in other words, I had nobody in the field. I was just running up and down the field with nobody tackling me. It was great. Again, that doesn't mean major things are going to happen. It just means that that is an angle that you have. And it worked, because the lobbying registration attracted the attention of the Washington Post. They came out, gave me a wonderful interview. They put on a big article on the front page of the business section where all the rich people go. Unfortunately, it had a huge photo, and it's the worst photo ever taken of me. I won't even show you, but you can find it if you look hard enough. One day I'll bring it out just to show you how well I've done since. And that was it. That was a credibility marker. But believe me, I had no illusions that I'm going to just go downtown and talk to a bunch of people on the hill. Before you know it, I'll pin it. No. But I like journalism. I like journalists. And I knew that when I entered the field in 96, that journalism was the key to activism. In other words, but Gandhi knew that. The movement to get rid of the British really got going when Life magazine turned up with some photographers and started taking photos of things and putting them on all around the world. And people are going, wow, that's what's going on there. And before you know it, well, and it's happened in other ways. So you get the journalist on an issue, they publish articles, that gets the attention of the public and the members of Congress and their staff. And they go, something going on here. We should look into that. And so I focused on the media. I've generated hundreds of stories regarding this issue. I've been in 170 or eight. I've been in 500. I'm at 550. I mentioned or PRGs at 550 stories. You would think, well, hell, that'll get you on 60 minutes. Well, no, not yet, but we'll see. Anyway, that's the path I took. I did what I could. And during those years, plenty of other people were doing stuff, again, trying to push us towards a breakthrough that would lead to an appropriate engagement. Stephen Greer did tons of stuff. and other activists, it turned out. And the conferences and the websites, the podcast, all of this isn't just because people needed a hobby. They're trying to get a message out there. And who's the target of that message? The American people, the American press, and Congress. But yet, by 2016, we had not made it yet. But it looked very promising. And then it took a nasty turn. Okay. And then in October of 2017, we had the breakthrough we had been waiting for since 1947. And that breakthrough took place over a period of 65 days. The launch of the TTSA, the announcement of the website and the resumes of the team, the delivery of the information to the New York Times to be vetted for articles, and the two published articles on the front page, December 16th.
And that's the To the Stars Academy, for a lot of people that may not know the TTSA.
TTSA, Academy of Arts and Science.
Yep.
The full name. So why was that the breakthrough? It was the combination of two things. One, it was the fact that the team was clearly coming. It was a team that was completely careered in military intelligence complex, stepped out into a private organization, and there was no indication that it was, as far as you could tell, a formal program at all. It was essentially a privately engineered project. And that meant that there was a growing group within the military intelligence complex that finally had decided it's time to end the truth embargo. But we can't do it. I mean, it's what? I'm a CIA person and I'm working at the CIA. What am I going to do? Launch a personal program to end the truth embargo? I'd be closed down in 20 minutes. No, we can't do that while working within the MIC. But what if we weren't working for the MIC anymore and we were part of an organization? We pulled our resources and that's
the military intelligence.
Military intelligence community.
Right.
That's right.
But there's different people at different levels here. We're just getting everybody keeping up on board here.
So this was a breakthrough. In other words, I said it right away in an interview. I said, for the first time since this began, the disclosure movement, it had come to be called capital D disclosure movement. The disclosure movement, which included a capital D disclosure event, my contribution, Greer starts the disclosure movement. I added a capital D, created an event, made it the prize for the activist movement, was being led by the military intelligence complex by proxy. Now that was a big deal. And every one of those resumes and that website was a clear message, something has happened. And then the second thing was the New York Times articles, that they took the info, vetted the info, published the info on the front page, put a Pulitzer, double Pulitzer Prize winner as one of the writers, along with Leslie Kane, obviously deserving of that honor, and Helene Cooper, one of their top military and writers in that area. She's really quite credentialed. They couldn't give it more gravitas. And you saw what happened. Immediately, things started emerging very fast. Massive news coverage. We've now reached 1,000 articles related to the TTSA's launch and the subsequent events related to that. 1,000 articles. They're on my website. You can go read them all if you got some time. That was the game changer. That penetrated. Right now, it would have had an explosive result, except that it ended up having to emerge during a very complex and unusual time. The political climate was unprecedented in the modern era, might have been unprecedented in the entire life of the Republic, who knows? And so it made it much more difficult to pursue the agenda that they chose, that I believe was a key agenda, to their great credit.
And these are the whole Trump administration plus the pandemic all coming together to be this unique, extraordinary series of events that took place coterminous with what's happening here. I'm sorry.
Even before the pandemic, to making the decision to go forward in October of 2017 into the storm, into the hurricane, was a bold decision, which history will reward greatly. They didn't know a pandemic was coming, right? So they're trying to get through these years because the situation was not what they'd expected. And then as things look like they may be getting better, in comes the worst pandemic in 100 years. Look, all I can say is every one of them should get the Medal of Freedom, as far as I'm concerned. So eventually the political situation settles down. The pandemic at least starts to become manageable and things start moving again. And now they're picking up speed. And so what I have stated repeatedly, and I'll state very quickly now, is that the ultimate goal of that group, aside from their other interests and possibilities, and they had unlimited possibilities depending upon how much money they raised, was to end the truth embargo and to do it by getting congressional hearings. That was the specific agenda, particularly of two key people, Luis Elizondo and Chris Mellon. And in due course, we literally see them putting the pieces together so those hearings could take place, though it wasn't obvious to everyone. And by and large, it all came together pretty well. And where it was going to go, of course, was unpredictable, but they had set the stage. Who would step up on that stage? Well, the person that stepped on the stage to finally take it to the next level was Marco Rubio. Unexpected. He did something bold and right. He put language in the appropriations bill saying, let's get a report. Let's get some information back from the agencies. He wasn't demanding. They dragged the Roswell crash vehicle into the Senate committee room and bring the bodies along. No. They were trying to get an update, an analysis of what's going on. In other words, he offered up to the DOD the opportunity to be helpful, right? Which would be a good look for the DOD. He put a deadline on it. Brilliant, right? 180 days from the signing of the bill, knowing the bill would be signed for months. It was signed in December, which meant the deadline was June 25. But understand, the language was published in July. And so the DOD had a full year to think about how would we respond to this? What will we do? And you see, the DOD is very good at gaming complex situations. That's one of the key things they're supposed to do. And so I assure you, they game this to death. And so anything that happened after that was going to be strategic. And a lot of people couldn't see it that way. They would go, well, this happened, I don't know what's going on. That happened, I don't know what's going on. They couldn't look at the larger picture and see the strategy that was unfolding. And so what followed after that is very predictable. You give the media a specific date on a specific event, and that is an easy story. And they have written articles by the scores, articles, maybe 200-300 related to this report. Right, worldwide articles, by the way. This report is coming, got a deadline, could be this, could be that. Fantastic. Got Rubio a lot of press too, which I think he probably enjoyed getting. So they put it in play. Okay, things went relatively slow again. We have a pandemic, but that didn't affect the government's, the DOD's actions. And what the DOD chose to do, as I see it, I'm wrong, somebody correct me or correct me later on, is this. Here's the strategy of the DOD. First, okay, we're gonna put something together, classified and unclassified. Before we put the classified report into the hands of the Congress, we're going to leak to the New York Times about 2 weeks ahead of time what's in the unclassified report, what the public might get, right? Smart move. New York Times publishes that, generates a lot of interest, but focuses it on the public report, the public report. That's not where the DOD wanted focused. I mean, that's where the DOD wanted it focused, not on the classified report, which was the report. Right? And so people are waiting for the public report. Meanwhile, 13 days later, they deliver the classified report to the four key committees and give them a briefing. But there's not a lot of attention put on it, right? Everybody's waiting for the public report. But it's the classified report that matters in terms of hearings. And so then the Congress, all these members of Congress have, six, I think it was another 16 days to look at it, consider it and what have you, and 14 days. And then the public report comes out and it's massively disappointing. Not to me, not at all. You see, the DOD doesn't want to give anything to the public. Not for nefarious reasons per se in this case, but giving any hard, solid, big, broad information to the public is going to create all kinds of issues. And worse, it's going to create issues for the Congress and the members in Congress on the committees. And so that's not something they want to do. They want to give it to the Congress And the Congress will decide what we see and hear. The Congress will decide about hearings, and the DOD can step back, which is exactly what they should do, because the DOD's prerogative is not to bring this information to us directly or to disclose directly. Absolutely not. That is the president's prerogative. They want to be in that game. And so you give it to Congress. But they had to put something to the public because there was a date. It was like, you know, Rubio wanted some public stuff. And so we got to give them something, right? We can't just give them a note and say, look, no, we decided just to go classified only. That wasn't going to fly. So they come up with 6 pages of classic DOD speak and a lot of acronyms. And the 2 key points they leaked to the New York Times back in the 3rd of June. So people are going, oh, yeah, that's what they said would come out. Then Rubio and Christopher Mellon gave us supportive statements about, okay, well, you know, that's good. Glad to have that. It wasn't a lot, but and so forth, which is appropriate, right? They could have shot it down. I was a little concerned that they gave those statements, but now I realize it was strategically wise. And then coincidentally, the Senate went directly into recess the day after that report, and it will return from recess on Monday. All right. And so in toto, these committees have had this classified information for 26 days to consider what to do about it. And of course, what to do about it is to have hearings. Now, there's already been, we think, 1 leak. Do you think the DOD was unhappy about that? No, no, no. If you've been in Washington a long time, you know that if you give 70 members of Congress some really significant, interesting information, unless it involves exactly where our nuclear submarine's on, it's going to leak. They wanted it to leak. Because you see, if it leaks from Congress, it's not coming from the DOD, is it? Right? Congress wants to leak. That's their prerogative. They represent the people. And it started to leak. Richard Dolan may have gotten a very significant report from the committee that was, I think it was transmitted verbally to a close confidant of Richard, who he trusts. That confidant wrote it down, hounded to Richard. He put it up on the internet in his last podcast. This, if it's a legitimate leak, is very, very significant. I hope you can find it. I can't have a page to share, but Richard Dolan, podcast leak, whatever. And he puts it up on the screen. And in a few words, here's what is in that very possible leak from the briefing in one of those committees. They briefed them on all of the advanced propulsion systems presently under development by our government, indicated that all of those propulsion system projects were being run under the aegis of DARPA and conducted by a group called, and managed by a group called Group 6. Okay, fine. It indicated that, yes, there were metamaterials, indicated in parentheses they were possibly ET related. And then they hit it with the key statement. And this key statement is very supportive. Ah, that's it. Hey, excellent, excellent, excellent. While I'm talking, feel free to read that. The key statement comes at the bottom, okay? And which they basically say, I can't actually read it because I've got some blocks there, but what they're saying is that we test these things, these propulsion systems are tested over the Nellis Air Force Range, right? And by the way, and they mentioned how it's funded, and these prototypes of flying crafts utilizing the above technology, which by the way, includes number 3 and a gravitational propulsion system. They're saying, yeah, we were working on anti-gravitic propulsion system. That is not trivial. We think they actually made some anti-gravitics. They've actually made craft with anti-gravitic technology that they've either figured out on their own or re-engineered. They're basically saying, yeah, that's significant. That is not trivial at all, but it's not in the public report, is it? And then they say, we tested these things over Nevada and people have maybe seen these things. However, here's the key statement. None of the experimental crafts have flown outside the Nellis test and training range. None of these experimental craft can be attributed to the sightings photographed by the US Navy. Do you see how significant that is? They are telling the Congress the truth. Yes, we have advanced propulsion systems. Yes, people might have seen these operating, but we don't fly them outside the Nellis Air Force Range. We don't fly them over Arizona, right? We don't fly them around our aircraft carrier groups. And that tech, the technology we have is not represented by those sightings. This one leak alone, if it were addressed in hearings, would blow the truth embargo sky high. And there are 73 pages of this. And so you see, they're doing what they should do in a way they should do it. They're giving the Congress the ability to now move forward, hold the hearings, bring the witnesses in, get the military testimony to back this up, and hand the president the platform on which he can appropriately, correctly, and in a valid way end the truth embargo as the commander in chief and the United States president, which is the way it has to happen. Any other way is damaging, destructive, and probably absolutely stupid. It has to come from the president, preferably our president, but he's not the only president. And so my next call, for those of you placing bets with the new bookies in town, everybody, there's bookies everywhere now, it's taking over, is that when the Senate starts up again on Monday, count the days. If I'm Rubio or I am Warner, I cannot sit on this situation with that classified report known to us, the public knowing that we have it, with leaks coming out, and not say anything about hearings or come up with some statement. Well, maybe next year we'll revisit this. I don't think so. I'm expecting an announcement from Rubio or Warner this week, coming week, that at minimum, they're going to hold hearings. And if we're lucky, they will give a time frame. And if we're really lucky, that time frame will be soon. So let's see how that goes. I'm excited myself and ready to get involved in any way that that I can.
So there is Steve Vasey's latest optimistic report about what's potentially going to be happening. There are people all throughout the UFO community with varying levels of information or sophistication about and experience in dealing with these issues. And so there's a vibrant conversation going on inside the UFO community now about prognostications about whether there's going to be hearings, if so, when, how much of this classified annex is going to get ultimately leaked or released. You know, that Lou Elizondo has now stated that rather than there being 73 pages in this annex, there are 400 pages. That Lou has now stated that there's 400 pages in this annex. And that's a big load. I mean, that's a lot of stuff that's in this report, and my judgment is that Lou is in a position to really know what's in there, and so the process of all of the different citizens, people who are outside of the Congress, people who are inside the Congress, people who are inside the executive branch, people who are outside the executive branch, people who are journalists, investigative journalists, other people who are in the media, anchor people and stuff. There's all kinds of people in our human community now that are involved in this conversation. And there are scientists who up until, you know, just in the last year or two, you know, felt that it was absolutely death to their academic career in their relationship with universities, to say nothing about government funding, for them to ever talk publicly about this. So there are people now in the Mensa crowd, in the scientific communities, who are now talking to each other about this, saying, wait a second, if the Defense Department is now acknowledging that these things are real and they're acknowledging that the highest probability is that they're extraterrestrial, you know, we need to be involved. Those of us in the scholastic community and in the scientific community need to be involved in this. And they are starting to talk among themselves now. So all of this stuff is boding well for this unveiling process to continue apace. And what we're doing is saying is that one of the other factors that I think is important is the citizenry ourselves saying, look, while all the effort is being made to get the different government institutions and media institutions and all of the other religious institutions and everybody to come forward as kind of representatives of the laity and the civilian population, you know, the citizens ourselves have to get busy. Because the citizens reaching out to establish direct communication with the extraterrestrial civilization, I can tell you, starts to strike fear into all of these institutions because they're saying, like, wait a second, what if we lose control? What if the citizens themselves start participating in direct communication with the extraterrestrial beings? What happened to our major effort at restricting democracy to representative democracy? That means us as the representatives, they're saying, you know, the educated elite, you know, and the people in the CIA and in DARPA and in all of these major institutions who view themselves to be the ones in charge of making decisions rather than we citizens. So this coalition of citizens all coming together in whatever our respective walks of life happen to be, you know, whether we're lobbyists in Washington like Steve or like citizens like ourselves or lawyers like me or journalists or people like Lou and Chris who've been in the government and are now outside of the government, people like Bassett and the other people, the CE5 people, all the people, or excuse me, and Stephen Greer, and all of the community. What we have to do is our whole citizens have to move together, everybody from their respective place in life, to push to get this to happen. And it includes reaching out to communicate with the extraterrestrial beings to basically say, very respectively, what the fuck are you guys up to? You know, what is it that you're doing? You know, what is it that you want? You know, what is it that you want to tell us? You know, how truthful is it of all the people that you've been having contact with saying that you keep saying we've got to get rid of the nuclear weapons? We've got to get rid of the nuclear power stations that are generating all of this waste material that's threatening to destroy our entire environment. We've got to get rid of fossil fuels so that we all have to do this.
And Danny, absolutely. We all have to do this. This is really why a citizens diplomacy initiative is crucial for a successful disclosure, because we have to show our representatives in Congress and at all levels that we demand this. And they need our support. They need to know, because they're worried about their jobs. They're representing us. And if we're sitting back and don't demand this, then they're going to take their direction from, you know, lobbyists and other, you know, other
corporations, military industrial complex.
Exactly. Yeah,
absolutely.
So it's critically important that there be a citizens diplomacy initiative, and that part of that needs to be a constructive, serious think tank. I think we need to take a lesson from the think tanks that exist, you know, the Heritage Foundation and the others that will remain.
The Brookings Institution, the Hudson Institute, you know, there are 42 think tanks that are all on the right end of the political spectrum, you know, but the people in the middle has the Brookings Institution, but nothing else. And people on the progressive side of the political spectrum don't have any. Well, there's the Institute for Policy Studies. There's one. So what I'm saying, there's our community has to develop a really first-class think tank, you know, this new paradigm institute to be able to come together, bring together the experts, bring together the scientists, bring together the researchers, you know, get people talking to each other professionally and responsibly, unemotionally, you know, not being protective of their own property or thinking that they've got the only answer, you know, so that we really share the information that we have. But I think it's critical that in addition to the think tank and the kind of scholastic research that we need to do to try to develop a completely comprehensive new paradigm that integrates this new reality, we've got to have an active citizens movement reaching out directly to the extraterrestrial beings themselves so that all of the representatives will say, wait a second, we've got to do a lot more than we've ever done before, or we're going to lose control here. You know, the citizens themselves are taking over. The citizens are rising up, and it, you know, democracy could break out here. So we've got to be able to demonstrate that democracy can be made real in this very special area. So that's why I think that both the New Paradigm Institute that we're talking about doing, this major think tank, is really critical, and the Citizens Initiative, the Citizens Diplomatic Initiative to establish contact with extraterrestrial beings directly. These are two extraordinarily important components that we all have to keep working on, and that we're going to be talking about in the event that's going to be coming up that Mark is going to tell you a lot about.
Thank you, Danny.
Comment?
Did you want to say something, Steve?
I would like, I'd like to. I think the citizen engagement has two fundamental aspects. One is engaging in contact, CE5, CE6, whatever, and also engaging the government. Now, trying to engage ETs directly actually goes all the way back to the 50s, but it really starts to become significant around 1990. And that's when a much more formalized effort gets underway, which comes eventually to be known as CE5. And I think these efforts to go out and make contact with these beings is not a problem for the disclosure process by and large. It isn't. I haven't really seen it as interfering. So that should continue. It's great. And it involves, and it's exciting, and it gives contactees who are maybe in the closet an opportunity to come out a little bit and get involved. So it's all good. Now, when we get to dealing with the government and contacting them, I would have just one thing I'd like to suggest. When I was a serious tennis player, I learned something that, I mean, this kind of sports like that, one-on-one, I always carried with me. And that is the only thing worse than a bad loser is a bad winner. And so I'd like to mention that we're winning right now. And so if you're going to engage the government and let them know that, try not to rub it in and try to be positive. In other words, don't get at them like, we're set up and we're angry, we're not going to take it anymore, and you're lying and you do this. And we want it now, we want it now. But rather just approach them with the idea of, look, we are aware you're considering hearings. That's definitely the thing to do. We're so pleased that you took this report. We're pleased that you're commenting on it and things like that. In other words, be graceful in success here. We are going to win. So I would temper the way that people engage the government and go from that point of view.
I agree. I agree totally. You know, we have to be graceful in victory here, and keep the victory coming. But the reaching out in good faith to the extraterrestrials, you know, we don't have to say it's contemptuous because you other people in the government, you know, you lost already. You haven't done. We don't have to say that at all. We just have to say that, that whatever the drip is that you've been engaged in for the last 75 years, this kind of feathering in of this information, okay, it's worked. Okay, we now get it. You know, there's a critical mass of us that are convinced this is true. And the perfectly logical thing for us to do is to reach out and establish direct contact with the extraterrestrials. So that's what we're doing, you know, and that we're going to keep on doing it, you know, and we're hoping that you're going to be doing your constitutional duty as well. And we're going to keep encouraging you to do that. We're going to cheer you on. But we're definitely going to be doing this. We've discovered what democracy is all about. Congratulations. You have succeeded in training us to be good citizens. And so here we come.
And there's an ever-growing number of us who've already been doing this as part of the CE5 movement.
That's right. That's right.
And so this is already underway. And what I would like to see and what I'm passionate about is taking it to a whole new level. Mm-hmm. How do we organize in effective ways on a global level to meditate and to put out the Harrigan call? We extend an invitation for you to show yourselves to the human family. And I think they will respond. In fact, I'm certain of it, but we have to reach some tipping point, some critical mass of coordinated effort. And along with that, show that we're responsible of this, that we have to remember there are still a majority of people who aren't aware of this issue, are just learning about the UFO, ET, UAP phenomenon. And so we have an obligation, I feel, as part of a citizens diplomacy initiative to help our, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, to educate them. And there, that needs a lot of thought and careful thought on how to do that. But we can begin the process. And what this Harmonic Convergence meeting in August is really about is beginning that process. And so we have a 5-day event. I'm going to put up real quick a website. Let me just, this went live today. Please apologize. I apologize ahead of time here about how basic this website is, but this will be, this is makingcontact.com. This is the new official website for the event that we're doing in August. So we will be putting up more information here, but at least now you can sign up.
Penny.
So this was just put up today, and you can put in your first and last name and an email address, and we will be following up with more information to you about the tickets when they go on sale, which we anticipate will be sometime in the next 2 weeks, that we'll have the full speaker and panel panelist organized. And so we're just now getting this off the ground. But the goal here is to begin this dialogue. And it's going to take place in virtual space. I'm going to really quickly show you.
Give us the website, Mark, for the...
It's makingcontact.com, which, of course, is the same name as your book.
You don't have to pay anymore.
Thank you.
And Stephen will be there, and Danny and Alan and Jimmy Church. Sylvain will be there, and many other people. Richard Dolan has committed. Whitley Strieber will be there. We have already an amazing A-list roster of the who's who in this field. But what we're really attempting to do here is to bring other people from other fields that don't typically associate themselves with this phenomenon or discussing it openly. And that those are the people that we hope are going to really make this special. And so, Danny, do you want to say anything else about that?
Sure. What I want to emphasize is that the structure of what we're going to be doing from August 18th to the 24th is trying to kind of help lift up kind of the professional quality of the study of what it is that we're talking about doing here, to understand that when, like a lot of people have heard me say it before, but way back in November of 2009, the Roman Catholic Church convened a bunch of scientists over in Rome at the Castel Gandolfo outside of the Vatican. And after that long conference, the Catholic Church issued a formal statement on November 11th of 2009, saying that, look, now in light of the discovery of more and more of these new extra exoplanets, that we're now, it's clear that we're going to be discovering life elsewhere in the universe much quicker than had been previously anticipated, is how they put it. And that therefore the time has arrived for the citizenry and the laity to begin a very serious conversation of the philosophical and theological questions that are posed to our human family by the discovery of life elsewhere in the universe. Now, in my capacity as the former general counsel for the United States Jesuit Order in their social ministry office in Washington, D.C., I reached out immediately to Father Jose Gabriel Funes, the director of the Pontifical Observatory, who issued the public statement, and went to see him. And within 2 minutes, he acknowledged to me that, well, they're not talking about single cellular life somewhere between a frozen, you know, planet in a distant star system. They're talking about another highly intelligent, highly technologically developed, but categorically non-human other species right here in our own Milky Way galaxy. And that the time has arrived for us as people and citizens to start discussing the philosophical and theological implications of this. Now, as a lawyer and as the counsel in the office of the largest single denomination in the Catholic Church, the Jesuit order, the largest order, I said, look, there's a lot more than just the philosophical and theological questions here. There's psychological questions, there's sociological questions, there's political questions that we have to come to grips with. And because everybody has spent so much time for the last 75 years trying to get at the question of whether these are real and whether these are extraterrestrial, that now that we're at that spot where we're crossing that all important line, the time has come for us as citizens to start engaging these fundamental questions. Because these are, I mean, I was astonished sitting in a meeting with the Defense Department with Lou Elizondo, with one of the main guys. And I said, all they kept wanting to talk about is, well, how fast these things went, what material were they made out of, how do they survive 600 Gs in these big turns. I said, wait a second, why aren't we talking about who's piloting these things, you know, and where they come from and what their agenda is? And it was like they were astonished, like, well, that's kind of beyond our pay grade. But this is not, it can't be beyond the pay grade of our citizens. We've got to come to grips with these questions. And that's what this conference is going to be about. From August 18th to August 24th, we're going to have a panel every single day of leading researchers and experts in the field to start talking about raising up these fundamental questions of philosophy and theology and politics and sociology and psychology. We're starting to do the job that we've got to do in order to prepare for this major paradigm shift that has to take place within our human family. And that's what this conference is going to be the beginning of. Not spending all of our time arguing about whether they're real or whether they're extraterrestrial or what they're made of or how fast they go, or even how many people have had direct contact with them or not. That we're past that line now, that we've got to get out ahead of the power curve and start coming to grips with the fundamental questions. And that's what we're going to be doing.
Can I mention something, Mark?
Sure, please.
Yeah, I think this kind of activity is propitious for two reasons. One, particularly given, I think, disclosure is so close, to the extent that you can get these kinds of people together, you can get these ideas out there and form some structures, you're going to be able to move much faster in the post-disclosure world where the competition for other people's worldview and attention is going to be rather intense. So that's a good thing. But the other reason is that I think that these kinds of activities are being observed by people within the DoD and within other parts of the government, the military intelligence complex in general. They're aware of what's going on. And I think this kind of activity would be encouraging to those inside in terms of their providing internal support for cooperation at the levels we'd like to see, because it clearly demonstrates the degree of sophistication and the understanding and the citizen involvement. And that's a positive thing. And it takes some of the angst out of their deciding, should I get involved here? Should I stay back? And so it's very good and very timely.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, Steve. And this is really my passion, is to help our fellow man and woman come up to speed, to become more sophisticated and educated on this issue and the complexity of it, because it is complex. And so we need an institute. Institute that exists in cyberspace where people can come and begin their process of being engaged in the information and the education and the dialogue, and then ultimately how to get involved if they wish, you know, at what levels, you know, whether to become an activist or to just simply become a member or like a student of the Institute so that they can learn how to become an activist if they wish, or just, you know, being, one of the people in their family that can share with other members of their family and friends what's going on, because this is going to be a big, big issue. And so we need to prepare people for this inevitability that we are going to make contact, and that, you know, the question that I always struggle with is the thing I struggle with is, do I think that the American people and indeed the world community, the human family, would they trust a contact event initiated by one of the superpower governments after all the history of the disinformation and the lies and, you know, some of the, you know, tragic stories that have befallen individuals who have tried to bring light on this issue? I struggle with that. And so I think, like many of you here and most people in the world, they would not trust. They would think it's a deep fake. If there was a mass media event, you know, that, you know, the UFO lands on the White House lawn and out comes the president and shakes the hand. I mean, I don't think it's going to work that way. I don't think, not only do I don't think it's going to work that way, I think it's a non-starter. And that's why I believe so much in a citizens' diplomacy initiative, that we have to do it. And the way it's going to unfold, first contact isn't going to be some, you know, UFO landing on at some UN location or, you know, embassy established in some third world country by a private organization or a public organization. It's going to be a global event. The first reveal, I'm calling it the Great Reveal. What I think would work, and I'm not predicting anything, I'm just suggesting that what's going to be key to a success here is that there be a movement that grows virally on a global level, and that this global community work together to bring about a big reveal event. And that big reveal is that there be points of light in the sky that make a pattern, that make it clear to everyone looking up at that moment that we're not alone. And then they go away, leaving us with the new reality, the new awareness that we're not alone.
And well, we just need to be careful of being too specific here. Strong personalities throughout our community have perceptions of how this might come about, you know, and people are even moving to try to build embassies and stuff. There's all kinds of different ways to approach this thing. What we want to do is to bring everybody together at this New Paradigm Institute to talk about all of these things and try to get an understanding of how we can join together to undertake coalition effort to get these things to happen. Right. And you can see, I mean, Mark has a very high level of enthusiasm and a great sense of specificity as to how it might all come about. Others do too, and we all have to share these things. And Stephen, you got one more observation, because we're running out of time here.
No, well, I just want to quickly add that look, there are projects happening all over the world right now. We don't even know about. There are projects going all over Hollywood in the film industry that you don't know about. Right. I assure you, the gears are moving everywhere. And so we can't be certain how it's all going to play out. We just know it's going to play out. And so we need to prepare as best we can for what role or what area we think we want to get involved in. And that will give us a bit of a head start. And I just want to add one more thing, and that's it. Danny's been working on the New Paradigm Institute for a very long time. It's well along the way. I know it's going to happen. But I said many years ago that my plan was, if disclosure takes place, I was going to convert Paradigm Research Group, funding, permitting, it takes a decent amount of money, but I was going to convert it into a think tank, Paradigm Research Group, make it a think tank, nonprofit. Expand the space where I'm at in the National Press Building and put it right there, two blocks from the White House. And so we'd have a think tank on the East Coast and one on the West Coast, But we need all the, we're going to need a lot of think tanks to deal with the post-disclosure world.
That's right. So it's, we got to get one going, a specific one where we can convene everybody. And Mark is gracious. Mark is going to be helping to provide all the technological knowledge we need to build this virtual New Paradigm Institute, so we can have extraordinarily high graphic qualities where everybody can come to be brought to the table together, to sit in a circle, to see each other out of the eyes of your own avatar, to see everybody sitting at the table and have this conversation just as close as amazing as can be to actual reality. The quality of the graphics are going to be, you know, quantum leaps above this, what you see right here, which is the observation deck stuff. But it's got all of the basics in here, of the meeting rooms, the use of the screens to project live stuff on, the holodecks, all of this. And what that this is Mark's background, where he's had businesses in the past, to up the graphic quality of all of this, so it feels exactly like you're right in the room. And this is going to be, even though this will cost a lot, it's nowhere near like what it's going to cost to build an entire embassy and or even build out the entire castle that we've got up on Clear Lake. But we're going to do this in virtual space. We're in the process of doing that right now.
Hey, you guys. I need to come in for a moment.
Yeah, we're running out of airtime. Yes.
There he is. Well,
here I am on my phone hooked up to a small computer. Mm-hmm. But I just want to acknowledge, first of all, thank you, Steve and Danny, for the amazing work you've been doing for decades. And what an incredible time this is. I mean, we are so blessed that, wow. And I really want to encourage everybody to go back and watch the replay, because what everybody has shared, Mark, Steve, Danny, Sylvain, Alvin, it's all very important. And I just, in a moment, we're going to bring Brother Cornflower on to play some music. And I want us to just integrate everything we've heard. And a couple of things that just really stand out for me that Steve said, hey, we're winning. We can leave where we've been for so long, which is angry at the government. You're not doing it. You're hiding bodies. And that's the mindset we've been in for so long. I really love Steve's suggestion that we leave that mindset and then taking it on to the next step. However it plays out is how it'll play out. Maybe it'll play out in such a way that multiple people have multiple experiences, right? Remember when the sailing ships came over to the New World, some of the Indians saw them and some of the Indians didn't see them because they were outside of some of those people's ability to see it. So let's really embrace this as an extraordinarily exciting time. It's a very powerful transformational time. It's clearly tied in to the transformation of our world, which we all know needs to happen, and the transformation of humanity, which we all know needs to happen. And how lucky we are to be a part of it and to be connected to people like Mark and Steve and Danny and Alan and Sylvain, and who are at the forefront. And so certainly Saturday Night Live, we're going to keep you all updated on everything that's going on. We're going to put our full support behind the August Making Contact events. And thank you, everybody. We are going to continue the show. We're going to have an exciting after show with Jimmy Church and some of our other speakers sticking around. But let's just all integrate what we've heard, because it's been incredible. And I can't think of any better way to do it than turning it over to Brother Cornflower.
I've got a hard exit here, so I've got to jump. We're in the process of having to make dinner. I love you all,
Danny. And thank you so much.
Terrific. I'll see you all very soon. Okay.
Right, and I'm afraid I have a hard exit as well. I went a little long. I thought I've got something I've got to do, but thanks so much for letting me be involved. And I wish all these projects great success.
Thank you so much. Thank you. All right, Brother Cornflower, help us to integrate everything that we've just heard. It's just, God bless you so much, Cornflower. Thank you. Thank you.
Just amazing. Just amazing, Cornflower. Could you just really quickly share with everyone how you produce your music this way? It's so fascinating to me.
Thank you. Yes. So it's all vocal. So everything you're hearing is happening using my voice, running through my mic, going into an effects pedal, but then adds a little color and texture to my voice. And then that goes into my loop pedal. So everything's happening live and in the moment. You know, I definitely feel like a presence. It comes in like a blue light, kind of like the one that's behind me right now, that sort of floats right above the right hemisphere of my brain and just to the back near my crown. And it shows up and kind of like sends me what the next note or tone or feeling or word or messages that I'm supposed to share. So I just sort of try to get out of my own way and let it come through. So yeah, it's all live and in the moment, all vocal.
It's remarkable. What a talent, what a beautiful way of, you know, composing and creating music. It's so powerful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Yeah, actually up on the screen, you should see a little square in the bottom corner. It's got my loop and my effects pedal and sort of my gear, so you can sort of see. Yeah, there we go. It's all my stuff. Anyway.
That is so cool.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cornflower. Thanks so much.
You're so welcome. It's such an honor.
So I'm going to turn it over to Alan. Alan's going to introduce our next guest. Alan, would you mind introducing Rebecca?
Of course, I'd love to introduce Rebecca, because Rebecca fits exactly into this progressive conversation we've been having, because we're trying to cover this. Actually, this evening, I think Jimmy would agree, has been a revolutionary overview of where we need to look at this phenomena on the social level, the political level, on the personal level. And so Rebecca is quite a genius in the angle she's created, which is called exoconsciousness. She developed that term, exoconsciousness, and she started the Exoconsciousness Institute, which is how do citizens start to interact with these other intelligences? How do we start to develop trade and commerce? among us as a planetary civilization, and also the whoever we'll be interacting with. We need to bring this into a kind of economic entrepreneurial level of contact. How do we create new industries that will go along with this, these first contacts? What does it mean for our society? So is Rebecca here? Did we lose her? Is she still here somewhere?
Unfortunately, Rebecca had to leave because we're running so late. Well, and so Rebecca
look
had
up
to leave.
Exo Consciousness Institute. That's Rebecca. She has a beautiful vision for laying out the foundations of a business world with contact as a primary aspect of this new world. So, yes. Sorry.
Deborah will put that. Deborah will put that in. And Rebecca did say she was loving what was taking place, and she definitely wants to come back. And I'm sure Mark will probably have her on his Making Contact events. So, what we can do is I'd like to briefly just do our Global Peace Tribe announcements. And then we want to meet Marina. We're really excited to meet Marina. And then we will head towards the after show. Cornflower is going to play one more song. We've got Jimmy Church still ahead of us. Of course, Alan and Mark. So there's a lot still ahead. I do want to thank all of you watching on Facebook. And guess what? You can still come into our Zoom room. And there's a lot going on in the Zoom room chat. So if you're wanting to have chat with Mark and Alan and Sylvan and all the different people you're seeing, come into our Zoom room. It's very easy. Just go to globalpeacetribe.com. Go to globalpeacetribe.com and register. It takes about a minute. It's also going to be really important for people to register so we have your email addresses. We will be sending out the replay of this very important show tonight. And we'll send it out on Monday to everybody. We also will include in there all the information about what Mark is going to be doing in August. And we're certainly going to keep you well contacted, but we need to know about what's going on. And we need to have your email address in order to let you know. This is incredible times. And we are the Global Peace Tribe. And we are every week bringing you what's going on in the world of raising our consciousness and planetary transformation, whether it's social and racial justice, which is what we're going to be focusing on next week, whether it is how to manage our relationships, addictions, codependencies, personal health and transformation, or of course what's happening on a collective level. So please go to globalpeacetribe.com and join. And I mentioned briefly that we do have next week's show. And Mark, if you can pull up the internet, unfortunately,
I'd like to do some announcements.
I'm operating off my phone. I don't have enough bandwidth.
Deborah wanted to jump in and make an announcement as well. Go ahead,
okay,
Deborah.
Great. Go ahead, Deborah.
Yeah, I just want to acknowledge what's going on here, which is amazing. That's why we are Saturday night alive. We are on the pulse of what's happening. You guys are amazing. So grateful to have you here. And we are going to be working with Mark ongoing. He is our major sponsor for tonight and has been. So we will be sharing all that's evolving with Harmonic Convergence. And I want to thank everyone for your donations. Really incredible as you register when you donate and to our GoFundMe. I'm going to put those links in the chat room. That's what helps us continue to do Saturday Night Alive each week. So we really appreciate your green love coming to us, and it's all going back at you. And there's other ways you can support our season 6, an incredible mix. We invite you to tell all your friends and family and share about this, because your word is golden. And so when you share it by word of mouth and on your Facebook and your email, people really pay attention. And we've got incredible shows coming up. Also, we have a promo video that we have. I'm going to put those in the chat room. And all our information is always in our email. The replay will go out on Monday, as well as a lot of links and information that you've heard here. So watch for the email that goes out when you sign up. And also, you can give a subscription away. You can pay it forward. So I'm going to put those links in the chat room too, where you can actually give a subscription away and turn your friends onto it. And if you want to volunteer and be part of the Global Peace Tribe team, that's also a possibility. I'll post those links in the chat room. Or if you'd like to sponsor a show for season 6, that's also possible. We're all working together here to get this incredible information out. And new season, we are going to be sharing our shows month by month now. And Scott has worked a lot to come up with some credible shows coming up. And Scott, you were about to share next week's show, which again is a whole nother level of what's coming up to the surface to be revealed and healed. And
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Deborah. Next week, we're really going to be focusing on how important it is for us all to play our role in creating equality in relationships, social and racial justice for all. And as you probably are noticing by now, this summer, during season 6, we are having amazing guest co-hosts for every show. Of course, tonight, our co-hosts are Mark Sims and Alan Steinfeld, who are doing an amazing job. Next week, my co-hosts are Pato Bonten and Antoinette Wutstataha. You've seen them on Saturday Night Live. If you've watched our previous shows, Pato is an incredible reggae musician, and he's doing a concert where I live. And so we're going to be with him at the same hotel where he's doing his concert, and he and Antoinette are going to be sitting next to me, God willing, as we host the show. And we are going to be listening to some of the great thinkers and speakers as it relates to social and racial justice. Reverend Bridge Feltus, Ava Park, Alexandra Loves, helping us to understand what is going on in terms of really creating more support for all cultures, especially Black Lives Matter. And then two amazing gentlemen who have made a huge difference in Native American and Indigenous world. Chief Reuben George, he and his pod, if you will, the people he worked with, have turned his entire community around. And Chase Iron Eyes, who is one of the leaders of the Standing Rock movement. And of course, Chase and Danny Sheehan have worked very closely together. And so both Chase and Chief Reuben George are going to share with us how they really turned things around. And once again, music with Pato Bonten and our beloved Nina Gray, one of our favorite musical guests. So that's going to be next week's show. It's going to be a great show. We're very, very excited about it. And the shows continue. I'm not going to go into a lot of in-depth, but we do have shows coming up on going deeper into addiction and recovery with Gabor Mate. We have a show coming up on whole body fitness. We're going to do another show on death, embracing death with compassion, near-death experiencers coming in, helping us to understand how to work with death. And so it goes. We're also going to have on August 14th, our wonderful friend, the Mystic Abbot, Jerry, is sponsoring a wonderful show all about healing. So this is what we've got coming up. Please register. Go to globalpeacetribe.com and register if you haven't already. And to share a little bit more, I'm going to turn it back over to Deborah.
And yes, Scott, we've got our a great special event for this next season with Jeff McBride. Did you want to announce about that, Scott?
Absolutely. I just needed a moment to pull it up. So we're really fortunate. As you probably know, those of you that are long-term friends and fans of Saturday Night Live, we have access to just amazing people. And one of the great magicians, he just was awarded, of all the magicians in the world, most popular. He came in third to David Copperfield and Chris Angel. So he's like one of the major magicians on the planet. And he's doing a private party just for Saturday Night Alive in the Golden Peace Tribe. I attended one of his previous private online parties. It blew me away. I said, Jeff, you got to do it for our folks. And he agreed. And not only did he agree, but normally the ticket is $100 and you can get it for $33. So come join us. It's an online interactive event. and he actually interacts with the audience. So it's not a Zoom webinar, it's a meeting. So we're all on camera. You can see all of us if you choose to have your camera on. It's July 28th from 6 till 8 Pacific time. Please join us. And there's a limited number of tickets available because it is kind of an intimate show. And this is going to be one of the most exciting and wonderful events we ever do. So don't miss it. A private party with Master Magician Jeff McBride.
One more announcement. Did you want to announce your Sacred Sunday, Scott?
I do want to announce my Sacred Sunday. And again, all I right. apologize, everybody. I'm operating out of a phone. And so I don't have all my normal bells and whistles and things to do. But tomorrow morning, I do have a really special Sacred Sunday show. And it's all about erotic health. And it's going to be with Eden Amadora. She's been on the show a few times. Thank you, Deborah. I met her through you. And we're really going to be talking about how, whether you're single or in relationship, how to really take self-love into our sexuality. And erotic health is important for everybody, no matter whether you're 30 or 90. We all have these beautiful body temples, and these body temples need to be loved and honored and adored. And Eden is going to take us through a couple of practices and help us to learn how to do that. So it's a really special show. And although it's about sacred sexuality, it's not, you know, California hot tub tantra, right? It's really genuinely dropping into life force and how to harness the life force in our bodies. So join us tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. It's going to be very, very special. And that's a show to come into the Zoom room for so you can ask questions. So like last night's Straight Talk, we had 50 people asking questions in the Zoom room. So come on into the Zoom room. Thank you, Deborah, for putting the link up.
About one more very quick announcement, just to continue this. If you want more, Neil Garr of Portal to Ascension is doing a spontaneous UFA UIP disclosure conference on Monday. Mark Sims will be there, as well as Alan Steinfield, Ray Hernandez, Grant Cameron, Zenka Caro, many others. I posted the link in the chat room, and he's one of our broadcast partners and just wanted to support this information to continue to go out far and wide.
Great. Thank you so much, Deborah. I'm going to turn it over to Alan Steinfeld, who's going to introduce Marina.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you, Deborah. This has been a really deep, informative show. So we went from the past, in a sense, the founders of this disclosure movement, including Whitley Strieber, who's really led the way, and Stephen Bassett, who's been on the political scene along with Danny Sheehan. These are the foundational pillars of this disclosure movement. And now we move into the next generation. Someone that I feel is already halfway there to ET contact, who in a sense has merged with this ET awareness. And when I found her, when I looked at her, I said, oh my God, these are hybrids among us. And in a good way, Marina, because it's not just that she's 21, which it's like, when you hear what she has to say, it's like, how could she have known? I could barely tie my shoe at 21, but Marina brings in the wisdom of the cosmos. So Marina, I want to ask, because Marina's in Spain. She stayed up all this time. She's about, what is she, from California? She's about 9 hours. It's somewhere in the morning for you. But what did you make of the past, hearing where we've come from, Marina, and where we're going to now, and sort of where you're taking the next level?
Well, I was meditating about many of the questions that they have been talking about as to how are we prepared for contact. Mm-hmm. And well, I have noticed that since the beginning of the start of my experiences with my own extraterrestrial contact and with my own UFO sightings, I have been observing that people around me are witnesses of how that impact on me change their own perspective, also on their own belief systems. Because when I share about my experiences at the beginning, there was a lot of contradiction with their own beliefs, with their own realities, and they will, most of them will believe that I was just crazy, or that, you know, it was something way out of, you know, reality. And what I'm observing is that now, since they are witness of the positive impact that it has had on me, they are becoming more open to all these things, including family members who were really close to hearing about all of these topics. My mother was not really keen to all this information, but she actually showed herself like intrigued, and she actually had a UFO sighting yesterday, which is amazing, after we had a conversation about it. So it's really amazing, you know. We are disclosure, and that's the point of it. It's not just about the government. It's about us people, about our own knowledge, our own stories, our own energy, because that influences a lot. And so the point is that I see many people kind of like interested in the processes that the government is taking in this agenda of disclosure. And actually, they believe that they are kind of like the head of this movement, that they have the control, that they are the diplomats. And I can tell you that I have had experiences in which the government actually abducted me to have meetings in the Pentagon. And they actually asked me for advice, because they know that we are the experiences. They have their own information of this kind of relationships with extraterrestrial consciousness, their own part of the piece of the puzzle, you know, the big picture. But we experiences, we spiritual people, contactees, we have other pieces of information that they need for that, for those processes. So they're actually asking us for advice. They're actually asking us for information. And I was there giving them kind of like the, a little bit of the picture of the protocols, you know.
Could you give us some of that, inside information, if you have to share any of that?
Yes. So I was, do you mean like my experiences with the Pentagon?
No, your experiences with the ETs and what they've shared with you and what we need to do. Yeah.
So what they shared to me is that contact dynamics are directly connected to consciousness evolution. It's all about consciousness, because everything is our creation and everything is our own energy. So any direct contact with any specific being or consciousness is a direct reflection of any contact with ourselves. So the more that we integrate our own fractal layers of consciousness that are vibrating in higher levels of frequency and energy, the more that we open ourselves to interact with that energy of that aspect of our own energy and consciousness. Because contact with extraterrestrials is just contact with a higher version of ourselves, because it's our own energy. We're multidimensional beings. So the process of integration of polarity consciousness dynamics is actually the way, or it's kind of like buying the opportunity, the tickets for contact.
So you've merged with these, you kind of channel some of this through. Do you want to kind of tap in and see if there's a message for this audience today? If you can just take a moment and drop in and see what comes to you, if you feel comfortable doing that.
Sure. I actually received the information from them on this night that I went to sleep. They want me to share, it's specifically, I have this information because of my own specific experience with the hybrid programs. And what they want me to share is the importance of the public becoming aware of the hybrid children and what kind of role they have on extraterrestrial contact. Many people are wondering and pondering how important, how relevant is for hybrids, the hybrids between gray and human DNA, to come here, and how they take, how it is that they have a big role in contact, what's their, you know, what's that they have to offer us. The point is that we have to go back into human history really shortly. We know that we are children of the Anunnaki, and that we share their genetics, and that we share a lot of their karmic energies also, because they pass it on us when they started the hybridization program with humanity first. Well, the point is that humanity right now was, you know, genetics are a consciousness matrix, you know, it's about quantum probability and manifestation. So our genetics were informing it's about the kind of like karmic cycles of evolution of the Anunnaki, the proto-sapien energy. So that's why we were exploring polarity consciousness. So the point is that we were projecting forward towards a path or a timeline that we're repeating those cycles. That's why in Atlantis we didn't make it. So the grays, who are the future version of us who explore that negative karmic cycles of energy, they come here to start the hybridization agenda so that they will help them and us, because if they start to inform our genetics matrix of that path that we do not want to explore, we will redirect our course of energy, our evolutionary path, towards a more integrated one in which we are no longer informing ourselves from those past energies of karma and third dimensional polarity consciousness.
So the hybrids will help us get out of the karmic cycle we've been stuck in, the trajectory of this over-intellectualization of that leads to a disconnection from the earth, ourselves, the planet, the stars. Would you say you're a hybrid pretty much in your integration? Because,
well, I have been told to not call me or any other human a hybrid, because mm-hmm. it's misleading. We are, it's true that we are hybridized, that we have received hybrid genetics, mm-hmm. but we have to call ourselves hybridized humans, because if okay. we say that we are hybrids, we're misleading people into kind of like making them understand that this is a hybrid energy. They mm-hmm. are the hybrids. We are hybridized mm-hmm. beings. So we are preparators for that energy, but they mm-hmm. are the hybrids frequency. Yeah.
Hey, Mark, do you have a question? Because you tune in, you look like you're listening intently here.
I am. yeah, thank you, Marina. This is very intriguing and very consistent with my own experience and my own learning through an extraterrestrial I met back in 2012. I've been on such a strange journey. One of the things that I feel called to share with you is this. I've never shown this to anyone.
Oh, really?
This was given to me by someone who I met recently. And I'm guessing you'll recognize this.
You do?
It's a woman who introduced herself to me about a month ago, who lives nearby. And she learned of me through the local paper. And I've been featured in the Ojai Valley News and in the Ojai Magazine since the Harmonic Convergence last year. In fact, I was just on the front page of the Ojai Valley News last week. This is the actual paper, and that's me. And Danny and I were interviewed for about the program. So the people here in Ojai are getting introduced to me, whether they want to or not. And as a consequence, this woman reached out to me and we met privately, and she mentioned, well, she's very much like you, strikingly like you. And as soon as I saw your face, I'm like, wow. So then you shared with me your website just literally 15 minutes ago when I went on there, and you have an amazing art gallery of artwork that you've personally illustrated. Yeah. And for me, it was almost like a confirmation. So I had to show you this gift that I was given. It's such a powerful thing. And people, this is the thing about disclosure, that I, having gone through it myself, from being on one total end of the spectrum, I was an atheist, I was a material scientist, classic secular individual with, and I was suddenly awoken, and it really took that experience for me to believe. I think that it's important for people to have a first contact experience right. on some level so that they know they need to see it with their own eyes. They need to experience it to get over that, because no matter how many stories you hear, I mean, it helps. Grease kids. So so anyway, I just salute you. Thank you for being here tonight, and I thought you would enjoy that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mark, you know what I would love is, because when you held that up, she got quite a look on her face. Would you be willing to hold it to the camera?
Yeah.
And then let's give Marina some moments. Marina, tell us what you're seeing and what that brought up for you.
Yeah.
Well, that reminded me of the idea, how this connects to the information that I was sharing, and it's that the mantids are the master geneticists. So they know, they are kind of like one of the most advanced being when it comes to geneticism and all of these science with hybridization. That's why they were being called for the hybridization agenda with the Greys and any other beings around the galaxy. So it connects to the background and to the ideas that I was sharing.
Hey, Marina, before you go, could you just give us a vision of what you see for the future of the planet?
Sure. What I have come to contemplate about the future of humanity is that there will be a time in which the dynamics of polarity will be integrated, and we will shift back from survivor mentality, which is what was kind of like programmed for humanity, the reptilian brain mechanism of victim, abuser, attack, protection, and all of these a negative versus positive polarity energies dynamics. And we will go to shift back to creator mentality, in which we are taking the divine responsibility for the creating of our own reality. And we will become actually galactic humans. We will be able to participate in many confederations, being part of galactic federations, and we will be recognized as mature individuals and connect and initiate first contact.
Hmm. Beautiful. Thank you.
I want to just take people briefly to her homepage.
Yeah.
As Mark talked about it, and this is where she has. You can learn all about Marina. It's her name, Marina, M-A-R-I-N-A, and her last name, Seren, S-E-R-E-N. So go to M-A-R-I-N-A, Marina, Seren, S-E-R-E-N.com. And
he has some great art here too.
Yeah, some very, very beautiful art. And it's one of those websites to really spend time on. All about the Starseed Awakening, some really good stuff about the Anunnaki. So, and Marina, hopefully you'll stick around. You know, we still have Whitley Strieber is still with us, and we're going to hear from Jimmy Church. Sylvan is still with us. And of course, Mark and Alan, our co-hosts. So we actually are going to have a really, really powerful after show. But I do want to kind of complete kind of the main show. Deborah, if there's anything you want to say to complete the main show, let me know. Otherwise, we'll be rolling into the after show in a moment. And again, the after show is going to include whatever our speakers that are still with us. And we're going to have one more cornflower journey. We're going to be Jimmy Church. So stick around for the after show.
I just want to thank Marina for staying up so late in the middle of the night and offering. And it was just her birthday. Now she is officially 21. And can you imagine what she has for the future of humanity there in this galactic leader we have here? So thank you, Marina.
Yeah, thank you, Marina. Thank you so much.
Thank you, all of you.
Yes, welcome to the major leagues, Marina.
Thank you.
Well, hopefully we'll get to her league, okay? I think it's more like that. All right, here's Deborah. You're muted, Deborah.
And I want to thank everyone for this show. This is the kind of show that makes Saturday Night Alive, because we're all spontaneously following our hearts, following our mission. And thank you, Mark, for stepping in as co-host, as we had a little blip there with the internet. And of course, Alan, you're a master at filling in. And we all came in to support Scott not being here for a little bit, but He's back. I appreciate you so much, Scott. I appreciate everyone. And it's always magic. Every single show blows me away every single week. So, so much love to you all. Thank you all for your donations that have come in. Thank you all for your support. And we're going to keep on keeping on with amazing shows for season 6. So all my love.
Beautiful. Thank you, Deborah. Safe travels tomorrow as you come from Tulum back to California. All right. I'm going to turn it over to you, Mark. And would you like to introduce Jimmy Church?
Yeah, I would. Jimmy and I met for the first time in Laughlin at the Laughlin UFO conference about 3 weeks ago. And it was just such a delight. He is so much fun. Such a great advocate for disclosure and knows so much. He's networked to everybody. He introduced me to people that I wanted to connect with and was just so gracious and such a help for me to reach out to people I wanted to invite to the Harmonic Convergence. And he wasn't planning on being the show. He wasn't invited. And this is one of the things about Jimmy, once you get to know him, he just magically pops up in your life. And so minutes before I was to go on with Scott in the pre-show, I get a call from Jimmy and he says, "Hey, what's going on?" And I haven't talked to him in quite a while, actually, because I had invited him and he had accepted my invitation to the Making Contact event, Harmonic Convergence event coming up. And so I needed to get back with him and I'd left him some phone calls and messages about the new dates. So I answered the call and he said, I just got off the phone with Danny and he tells me he's going to be on Saturday Night Alive tonight. Do you mind if I drop in? And I said, I'd love that, man. That would be so much fun to have you as a cameo, a host or guest. And he turned out to be a cameo host because, you know, when Scott had his technical problems, he filled in beautifully and right on time because I've never hosted this program before, not like Scott does. And so Jimmy, he's really become a fast friend very quickly. I gifted him one of these Metatron cube lockets that I designed and had made by a friend of mine in Bali, and he's wearing it now. And by the way, I have an announcement about for people who would like to buy one of these. I have a new Shopify, and I have about a few of these left, and I'll be offering them to people who are interested. So that I set that up so that I can just point people to that who ask. Anyway, those of you that would like to buy one of these, let me know. Just throw it in the chat. I saw somebody recently. I'm going to reply to you, and I'll send you a link where you can get it. But Jimmy, you're on, man. So tell us what you think about our show.
I'm just going to let everybody know. That wasn't cornflower singing. That was actually me from the studio doing it live. Okay, everybody laugh. That was amazing. Just absolutely amazing. And I've been here through the whole event tonight, and I just learned so much. Marina, holy cow, right? Just absolutely fantastic. Mark, I want to tell you that there's a buzz coming in. Does everybody hear that? Is everybody muted? Who is muted?
I think it's Scott.
Oh, there it is. Oh, I have the feeling it was Scott.
Yeah.
But, you know, coming off of what was something that nobody wants to talk about anymore, which is 2020, right? Okay, so and I'm not going to spend any time talking about that, but we had the opportunity to go out and do the conference over at UFO MegaCon, yourself and everybody that was there, but to get out and to see human faces again and to get back into the community and hang out. And I was so excited to do that. Part of that for me was being able to hang out with you. And the medallion, by the way, it's absolutely amazing. Here it is. But the disclosure movement and the ability to get out and to mingle is so important for all of us. And then to come in here tonight with a Saturday Night Alive, just incredible. But I also know what is going on right now behind the scenes. I'll just let everybody know. If anybody was watching me, I'm texting with Lou Elizondo tonight throughout the show. He's paying attention, everybody, okay? Danny coming in tonight on this show. And what is going on? Danny Sheehan right now is up against the forces of Washington, D.C. Danny Sheehan, the Department of Defense, everything that is going on there, trying to get this moving forward as quickly as we can, but to navigate the labyrinth of the Pentagon, the White House, Washington, D.C., politicians, three-letter agencies, all of that. I don't know how that gets done. Danny is doing that for us. And he just came off of one of the busiest weeks ever. I'm speaking to him today on the phone as he's racing back to get to this event tonight. That is Danny Sheehan. And I want everybody to know that is with us right now. We need to thank Danny Sheehan. I can't imagine the pressure that, and this, there's something else, Mark, that Danny's going to be with us on Monday night on Fade to Black, along with Lou Elizondo. And so I'm just doing a little, it's not self-promotion. This is a sneak peek. You know, Danny is going to go from tonight and from what he did yesterday and the day before all the way through Monday night. Him and Lou are going to be on Fade to Black talking about these very important subjects. But Danny Sheehan, Watergate, the Pentagon Papers, Iran-Contra, Karen Silkwood, the recent Dakota pipeline situation.
John Mack.
Alan Steinfeld coming in from the background. But yes, right? Constantly moving this thing forward. And I can't thank Danny Sheehan enough for everything that he has done. And to have him here tonight with all of this was incredible. And again, a little back, anybody can jump in at any point. But through the busy week that I had on this most recent film shoot, but I'm with Whitley. I'm with Richard Dolan, William Henry, and Linda Moulton Howe. And we were together from early in the morning till late at night getting this film shoot done. But that's not what is important. Well, the film is fun and it's important, but it was watching Richard Dolan sit with Whitley for hours and talk. Watching Whitley and Linda just talk. Watching Whitley and William Henry just talk. Whitley was here tonight. I was with Whitley until 10 o'clock last night. I don't know how he finds the energy.
Whitley is still here with us.
Whitley, come on in.
I'm actually putting the spotlight on Whitley. Yeah. And Jimmy, can you put into the Zoom room, put in how people can get onto your show Monday night?
It's jimmychurchradio.com.
Okay.
Simple enough. Jimmychurchradio.com.
You're here too.
Whitley, I just drink a buttload of coffee. Everybody knows that. I have been with you all week. Where do you find this energy to just keep the fight up for us?
Well, my chair is losing energy rapidly. If I disappear below the surface, you'll know why. You know, I'm a very energetic person. I'm not a sleeper.
Hey, Scott, can you mute?
I my day starts, I wake up about 6:30 and I do my sensing exercise with a group of people at 1, and then I do it again at 11 by myself, and at 3 in the morning with the visitors and whoever or whatever else wishes to show up at that hour, which is all sorts of different things. And I think it's very energizing. It's a matter of taking the attention from the flow of thought and putting part of it on the body. And when you do that a lot, it's just a very healthy thing. It's a very healthy method of meditation.
Don't you meditate at like 3 a.m.? Don't you have an alarm set?
Every night, yeah. It started, it's interesting. The first period when I did it was in the late 90s when a group of people who said that they were from between lives started coming to our cabin, and they would come banging down onto the roof, seemingly physically, and then come into the meditation room non-physically. And the first time that happened, I was sitting there meditating, doing the sensing exercise that I do. And I thought to myself, I can't handle this. I can't do this with a bunch of visible people. So I said, look, I'm going to bed because, I feel it's just too creepy. I can't handle it. And I have to see you. And in the middle of the night, I was awakened by someone punching me on the shoulder. And there was a man sitting on the end of the bed. And, at first it scared the hell out of me. And then I thought, oh my God, it's one of these people. And I briefly interacted with him. Nothing was said. I held his hand in my hand. I smelled his skin, which was very strong odor. It was a very ripe, obviously wherever he was from, they don't bathe. And then he disappeared, and I meditated with them for about a year. Then we lost the cabin. We had to leave. And after Annie passed away, it started again with her. And then with the Grays or the visitors too. And it's been going on ever since 2015. And I do it, it's my life. That 3 o'clock meditation is related to something that in some disciplines of yoga is called Brahma Muhurta time, and which is the time of learning. And it is very valuable to open yourself at that hour and just let the universe in. And that's what I do every night. So I'm basically never tired. I'm not tired.
I wish I had that discipline. Mark, are you with us?
I am. I forgot that I had a password protecting the Metatron Cube Shopify website. So I had to figure that out. I had set it all up a few days ago, and I had password protected it because I wanted to only make this available for early buyers, early bird people, especially people here that have expressed an interest, because I have a very limited inventory. I've only got like 24 left.
Mark, but we'll get back to the Metatron. I promise you, we'll get back to that.
Hey, Jimmy, I just have a question. Jimmy, I just want to know, you've been texting with Elizondo. What does he think of people like Whitley and Marina? Did he have a comment about what he heard tonight?
What we were actually talking about, I can't really get into the private stuff, but let me say this. He, there is, I need everybody to brace themselves. There is a 23-minute UFO UAP video that the government has that has been seen. And we're working on trying to get this released. 23-minute UAP UFO video.
High definition, I heard.
Well, the whole, oh, you've heard about this. See,
yeah, it was he did an interview with something witness and he talked about that for the first time. But tell us more. Tell us what you know.
Well, I'm only telling you, well, I said, Lou, how come I haven't seen this yet? He said, when's it going to get released? Well, we're going to talk about that on Monday night. I don't want to put words in Lou's mouth, but he did say, I'm going to paraphrase. He said, I said, when will it get released? He said, when the government's ready. So I don't know. The talk is out. When something like this happens, usually something's going to get leaked. I'm really looking forward to that.
He says it's going to blow people's minds when they see this video because it's undeniable. You can see little triangles and say, well, maybe that's this. But this thing is the thing.
Yeah, this isn't going to be another Corbell Flying Toasters video. It sounds pretty extraordinary. But I wanted to get back to this. Mark, check your cell phone.
Okay. I see it.
Okay. Oh, can you get that posted in Zoom for me?
I sure will right now. Let me
post that in Zoom because this is a picture that I took this week. Richard Dolan came up to me a little bit later after I took this picture and he says, Jimmy, I need to have more conversations with Whitley. I need to talk to this man some more. What an incredible conversation. What an incredible week. And I took this picture. They didn't know this. I was on the other side of this big room, but I caught them talking. And here's the picture. Whitley, there it is. Whitley, take a look at your screen. You didn't even know I took that picture, did you?
No, I did not.
And that is... That is Richard and Whitley engaged for quite a long time. I kept walking through there and they're still talking. Another cup of coffee. And so I walked back through and I just thought I'm going to capture this moment. But Whitley, that's what you mean to us in our community. And Richard wanted me to thank you. And I thank you just for taking the time tonight. Yeah, it's great.
Lou Elizondo will come along one of these days. I know a lot about Lou Elizondo, but since I don't know him personally, as he will not talk to me, I can fill in the very polite gap that you left.
I can make that happen for you, Whitley. But these are what exciting times that we find ourselves in. You know, if you go back to Whitley for you in the late 80s, Alan was a part of the movement back then and his TV shows and his interviews. And so many that are here, Deborah. And if you go back to the way things felt, you know, in the late 80s, these revelations that were coming out, certainly communion and suddenly Area 51 was being talked about. And then we had the MJ-12 documents and Roswell bursted out onto the scene. It seemed like we were on the verge then. Well, it appears to have taken more than 30 years. Whitley, do you think that 30 years was too long? Or is this too short? Do we still have some more work to do?
It all happens at the right time. We're over the next few years, the pressure, mankind and all of the creatures of the earth are going to be under is going to be extraordinary. And face-to-face living and confrontation with this, these other levels of reality, these the visitors, is very difficult. And we will have to work hard within ourselves to succeed at it. Unless we had grave need, we would not do it. But we will have grave need and we will do it. And it's a matter of waking up. Look at it this way. Beginning of the age of Pisces, Jesus, the fisher of men, the Pisces, of course, the symbol is the fish, started just a little over 2,000 years ago. And the little fish of Pisces swam around in the waters of the earth, protected and given everything it needed to live. Now comes a change. We come into the Aquarian age. The waters have poured out. That's why you see all of these fires and all of the drought, which will come to define our age, by the way. And the little fish is poured out with it, because the womb of the earth, the waters of the earth's womb are breaking. They're breaking. And we're being poured out onto the dry land. How does a little fish learn to live on dry land? All he knows how to do is swim. And of course, we're going to be screaming like crazy. All babies cry when they wake up, when they come out of the womb. It's the first awakening. Now, the second awakening is now. And it's all of us. All of us. We are going to experience a second awakening. And it isn't going to be easy. It's going to be initiatory in the sense that it overturns your entire experience of reality. That's what the close encounter experience does to people. When you have a physical encounter with the visitors, it's not, the people who really have them are deeply shocked and undone by it. And they then have a choice. Either I close down and I don't take this any farther, or I decide I'm going to try. And a lot of people decide to try. And a lot of these people in the close encounter experience, some of them speaking here tonight, woke up or awakened. Mark had it happen to him. He woke up. He was shaken out of his tree and woke up just like me. And
sure was.
So many of us. Absolutely. This whole planet is in a situation where it's going to either wake up or it's going to be a stillbirth. And I know some of these visitors very well. You talk about Chinchy, you have no idea. They wouldn't be here if they didn't think there would be a payoff. In other words, us surviving. So my money is on us surviving. But it is going to be a journey and a half, believe me.
My money is on fun, too, as well, Whitley. Whitley.
Well, like Danny used to say, have joy.
That's right.
It's one of the few things I ever heard spoken in the physical level to me from one of the visitors, this little being that sounded like a child or a little girl, said, have joy. And I told that to Anne, and she immediately picked up on it. She said, that's it. That's the key. Have joy. Her favorite, she was a great student of theology, and her favorite theologian was Meister Eckhart, the 12th century German mystic. And his sermon, he has a sermon called God Laughs and Plays. And she said, Whitley, if you laugh and play, you're going in the direction of God. So,
Whitley, thank you so much, my friend. Thank you so much. Get some rest before your 3 a.m. meditation. And I'll talk to you tomorrow.
that. I'm going to be.
You know, it's so perfect that you talked about joy, because Cornflower has been with us also since the beginning. And so I want to turn it over to Cornflower to take us into the joy of his music.
I just want to say about Cornflower, such energy. Thank you, Cornflower.
Yeah, Cornflower, let me know if you need backup vocals, because I got them pipes. Listen, everybody, I got to get ready for this week. I want to thank Mark, everybody here. Deborah, thank you so much. Scott, you're amazing. Marina, don't change, young lady. You don't change. I need to talk to you. But thank you to everybody. Hey, Sylvain,
thanks
incredible.
For being part of this historic show. This covers it all. I think if people should study this, because this has been foundational from Whitley Strieber and Danny Sheehan and Stephen Bassett really setting the platform, till Sylvain showing us what the possible future, and Marina and Mark taking it into the people's movement. This has become an initiatory movement that we just had tonight.
Yeah, thank you so much, Alan. Alan, don't ever stop causing trouble. I want everybody to know I do shows 4 days a week. You know, everybody knows that. But what they don't know is I steal my best material from Alan Steinfeld.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Alan. Everybody.
I'm giving it away. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much. All right. Everybody, have a great night. Thank you so much.
All right. Bye, Jimmy.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Share quick something that Whitley was talking about with regards to you know, really waking up, you know, for all of us to wake up. And then Marina was also talking about earlier just vibrational.
Can you put your mic up a little bit, Cornflower? You're a
yeah
little...
thank you. Yeah, so okay, so I just wanted great to speak. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, so I just wanted to quickly speak on just what Whitley was talking about having, you know, the people wake up. And I think that's directly correlated to what Marina was talking about our consciousness and, you know, what we see and experience and what we draw into us is equal to our level of consciousness, our vibration. And, you know, one of the things that I've been really working with in my life recently is embodiment of who I really am. And, you know, one of those things is remembering that I am a part of the earth, and that we're not separate from this planet. You know, we're native to this planet. You know, even though there is the hybridization, but that we were born from this earth. And so to really ground into that and to understand what it means to be a part of the earth and not separate to it. And I think that, you know, would transform a lot of how we interact in the world with, you know, laying down our swords and shields, you know, returning to our hearts and having more compassion for life. But anyway, this song is called Hear the Call, and it's spoken from the voice of the earth. So when you're hearing the lyrics, think of it as the earth speaking directly to you. And let me get the timer on here. All right, here we go.
Thank you.
I've gone to Gallery View where you can see Jay and Jerry and Sylvan and Marina and Alan and everybody just appreciating you so much, Cornflower. So
appreciate
much
you guys
appreciation.
So much. Thank you all for co-creating. And, you know, if you want to tune into more of what I'm doing, check out cornflowermusic.com and sign up to my email list and join in on our big event that will be coming up. Looking forward to seeing
it. There it is. There's Cornflower Music. And as always, Cornflower always has lots of wonderful things on his website as I kind of scroll. And it is all around you. Anyway, let's definitely make sure you sign up so that you can get more Cornflower. Of course, you'll see him here on Saturday Night Live, usually once a month. Cornflower, we love you so much. You are just such a precious part of our community.
Love you guys, too. Such an honor.
Mark, I'm going to turn it over to you for a bit. Of course, I know you're going to do a CE6 for us, I believe. I also, a lot of your friends are still here. Whitley, Marina, Sylvan, Alan. So however you want the after show to flow.
All right. So we've reached the end of the show. And I just want to thank all of our guests who appeared tonight, and especially those of you who are still here. It's just such a wonderful evening and morning for those of you in the UK, like Marina. It's, I think, about six, almost approaching 6:30 in the morning there. Is that right, Marina?
Correct. It's six, almost 27 a.m.
Yeah.
Madrid.
Oh, yes. You've been a real trooper. And just thank you so much for, I mean, what a thrill. I didn't know anything about you. And Alan suggested we have you. And Alan, thank you for bringing these amazing people that you know through your network and all the work you've, you know, done in your storied career. And well, wow.
It's just beginning for us, Mark. We are connecting the dots, all of them. I form this big picture.
I'm going to be reaching out to you, Marina. I think you're somebody we want to have as part of the Making Contact conference. And we're putting together this amazing experiencer panel with Whitley as leading it. And I think you and Whitley and some of us, you know, I'll be there, of course. I'm an experiencer. I think we'll really have a unique presentation or discussion on these messages for humanity that we're receiving. And you're just so articulate in your information is so important. I mean, I can tell just in the short amount of time you've been here tonight, you are bringing truth, important information to this community. It's so few people can, you know, accept that and even understand it. It's because partly they can't even understand what you're saying. But I have been researching this. You're bringing pearls of wisdom. You are truly bringing pearls of wisdom. My hat is off to you. I can't wait to learn more from you and talk to you and compare notes. And I think we all have, you know, important information and pieces to the puzzle. And this big picture is emerging, and the more pieces we fill in, the more amazing it is and wonderful. And it's not scary. It's really, truly a celebration of epic, global, universal proportions.
I just want to say to Sylvain, this is one of our ambassadors, Sylvain, right?
Marie? Yeah, wonderful.
I mean, we're preparing for the future. I mean, so.
So what a marvelous evening. I'm going to close this evening out with a meditation. So this is a custom thing that's evolved over the 9 years since I learned the CE5 protocol from Greer originally, that led to my contact. And then with the teachings of Tejbar, I have modified my own meditation, and it's what I do. It's called Singing the Hue. We're just going to sit, find a comfortable place to listen to my voice, and we're going to close our eyes here shortly. But It's important that you're, most important that you're comfortable and that you're, we're going to do a few deep breaths. And the breathing, it's important that you know that this is part of the science behind contact. Our bodies are a technology, literally. It's a biotechnology. And by breathing deeply and seeing this hue, we are oxygenating our blood, and that oxygen is carried to every cell in our body. And that energizes these cells. There's things called mitochondria. They're a special organelle within each of our cells, or at least most of our cells. And they're like little batteries that charge the cell. And that's what we're doing, is charging that up, bringing each of our trillions of cells, 10 trillion, 20 trillion cells online. And as we bring our cells online, each one of these things, think of them as a unit of consciousness within us of which we are made. We're bringing that, we're waking them all up. And when we bring them online and we put our intention to making contact, we are literally cell by cell making contact. And that energy that is within us is expanding and reaching out through not just space and time, but through higher dimensions that our star family can access and communicate to us through. So this, we open ourselves up for communication. This is what's happening here. And the breathing is crucial component of it. So let's close our eyes. We're going to take a deep breath through our nose and out through the mouth. And one more cleansing breath in through the nose and out through the mouth. So when we breathe out through the mouth, release the stress. We breathe in, and we release the stress through the exhale. One more time. And now we're going to sing the hue. We're going to do this for 20 minutes. And just sing the tone. There's no correct tone. Just do what feels right. And as we let the breath out through our mouth, creating this tone, we're going to make a sound together, a harmony. And just imagine that you're singing a song to our star family in gratitude, because we are literally here in large part because of them and other higher dimensional beings and source itself. And so it's a song of gratitude and of love. For being alive, we are a miracle. We are a miracle. There's just no doubt about it. The moment of the Big Bang, there's this explosion of pure energy consciousness, and we come out of that is mind-blowing. And here we are together. Let's give thanks for the mere fact that we're alive.
And hey, Mark, would you like us to open our mics so that we can hear each other's sound?
Whatever you prefer. And so, yeah, if you want to join in, sometimes Zoom doesn't quite, do a good job of mixing, or creating a composite sound. It becomes irritating. So if it's irritating, just mute and I will, give, but it often doesn't work well. So it's up to you guys. I'll leave my mic open and just mute me if it becomes annoying. All right. Thank you.
Hey, Mark, if you can hear me, unfortunately, your hue sound is not coming through. We're not getting your sound. It's probably because the vibration's too high, but the people in the chat box are all, of course, we're loving the energy, but we're not able to hear anything.
Okay. What I will... I don't know what to do because my mic is open and it very well may be that Zoom is filtering the sound because it's thinking it's background noise and trying to. So I'll try going louder and see if that will work. All right. Thank you.
Mark, is your original sound on or off?
My mic is on. What other sound are you referring to?
If you go up into the upper right-hand corner, it'll say either turn on original sound or turn off original sound. Do you see that?
I don't. Turn on original sound or turn off original sound.
Okay, if it doesn't show up on your screen, go to the audio settings. There's a little audio right just to the right of the mute button. Open up your audio settings box. And is your...
Are you talking about the Zoom preferences?
Just to the right of the mute button, there's an arrow. Click that arrow and open up the audio settings.
Oh, I see.
Okay. And when you open up the audio settings,
okay. testing, one, two. Okay.
So on the audio settings, do you have your, would you kind of go down to where it says music and professional audio?
Yes.
What do you have clicked or not clicked?
Not selected. Show end meeting option to enable original sound.
Right, so change it. Whatever okay. You go to the opposite and see how that works.
Okay, I've got echo cancellation, high fidelity music mode, and stereo audio.
Try clicking echo cancellation and okay. High fidelity music mode.
All right. All right.
Let's see if that works a little better.
Thank you.
Sure.
Probably it's bubble bubble.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, it's not picking it up, is it?
No. Nope. Oh. Yeah, it's not picking it up.
Let me try something else. You.
That worked.
Now, is it? Are you still hearing that?
We heard it for a second, and then it stopped.
Yeah. Let me try this. You. Let's see what else I can try here. Okay. Oh, here. Let's try that. You. Wow, it doesn't want to pick it up.
Yeah, it starts, we hear it lower, but when you get high, it doesn't.
Let's see if there's anything else here that is obvious. Let's see. No, it's not.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. It did work when you've done it before for us. I don't know why it's not working today.
I'm not sure why that's not working.
I do want to acknowledge we still have 168 people in our Zoom room. They're amazing. God bless you. And still have Whitley and Brina and Sylvain and Alan with us. So what an amazing group of people wanting to experience. Yeah, as Leanne writes, 160 hewers.
All right. Well, I guess we'll do is we'll just continue. Once I stop hewing, then it picks up my voice. And so why don't we just continue hewing silently to ourselves? Those of you that wish to turn on your mic, and well, I'll get to hear you. All right, so let's do this until 10 o'clock Pacific time. It's 9:45. We'll do this another 15 minutes and then we'll come out and finish the evening, okay? Yeah, thank you, everyone, for staying around and joining in this. This is really special to me, and it's a real honor and pleasure to do this with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. It's 10 o'clock Pacific time, 7 in the UK, 7 a.m. Let's just take a moment and go into a three minute silent contemplation. Let's just marinate in this moment in the energy field we've created around the body and within ourselves, within the body. Okay, everyone. Wow, that was quite powerful. And I know you can't hear it, but there are literally birds outside my window here. I'm next to a door wall. And there's birds out there chirping. It's now 10 o'clock at night, and I can hear them out there chirping. It's crazy. This has happened before, but not like this. Wow. So, well, I am going to go, you guys can hear it. Wow. You guys can hear the birds too. Wow. This has happened before. I'm literally hearing them out here. Maybe they're coming through the speaker. Maybe somebody is piping in bird music or chirping, but it's, I'm getting it from outside. That is really
remarkable. Yeah, I can hear the birds. Yeah.
All right. Well, wow. Well, I again want to thank everyone. And I am going to join my friend Marco on, let me just find his link. He was putting it up on the chat. This is a friend of mine from Michigan, where I'm originally from. I only moved to California about 4 years ago from Michigan. And so Marco, if you're on, could you post that link to the, here, you know what? I've got it right here. I've got it.
He posted it up.
Okay, great. So I'm going to join everyone who wants to continue the meditation. I'm going to continue leading the CE5. I'm going to go outside and join in that Zoom room. And I hope you guys can join me if you're up to it. Again, thank you to all the guests, all of our guests, my co-host, Alan Steinfeld. Brother, I love you. You're amazing. Just you cease to amaze me with all these people, these amazing people from all over the world you bring and introduce me to. I'm so lucky to have you as a good friend. So everyone have a wonderful evening, and we'll go see you on Mark's Zoom room. All right. Good night, everyone. Or good morning, Marina.
Good morning.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much, guys. It's a pleasure to have been here.
Yeah. We'll be seeing you again soon.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Oh. A raccoon just walked by my window here. Oh my God.
Animals are very sensitive to these types of meditations and vibrations.
Wow.
I've seen that many times.
Yeah. All right. Good night, everyone. Good morning, right. Marina.
Morning.
Good night. Good morning.